are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support the show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
Children International is working to end child poverty around the world by giving kids access to a safe place, a team, and a path out of poverty by focusing on health, education, empowerment, and employment. Together with people like you, we're more than a nonprofit. We're a powerful force for change. Learn more at children.org.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Thursday, November 10th, 2016. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the four-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, Adam Green, co-founder of the Progressive Change Campaign Committee, on what the plans are for now. Then we'll be talking to Ari Berman of The Nation magazine on what role voter suppression played in this election and what we can anticipate it playing in future elections. Also on the program today, protests across the country. Big, big protests. Not our president. Republicans begin to outline how they will repeal the Affordable Care Act. Scott Walker encourages them to get rid of the filibuster. We now know at least one version of potential cabinet picks. It's as ugly and demented as you would guess. Russia claims it's had multiple ongoing contacts with the Trump campaign. And Omarosa, unclear, she's probably just a special advisor, claims that she's keeping, or they're keeping, an enemies list. Bernie Sanders comes out with a strong message to the thing in elect Trump. All that and more on today's program. It's going to be hard for me to say. I was on Hayes last night, and I guess I did not refer to Donald Trump as President-elect Trump. I mean, I don't know that I'm ever going to do that. And then once he's president, I don't know that I'm ever going to call him that. And so I'm just giving you a fair warning. Some people were complaining about the protests. Some people were talking about, I think the criticism I got was that by not calling a president-elect, that was, how outraged would I be if someone did that with Obama? And I wouldn't be terribly. I think I say President Obama. I think I use both. And in fact, on this program, we do impressions of Obama. And
we get offended when he's not actually called Amir Obama.
But the point being is that, Democrats have a choice. And I think all of us, broadly speaking, whether you're a Democrat or not a Democrat, all those people who have witnessed Donald Trump's ascendancy to the presidency via, questioning the birth of the president, watching Republicans smash and shatter norm after norm. I have a question, and that is basically say, is it really strategic and smart and necessary for us to maintain the norms that they have already shattered? That's the thing about shattering norms. They get shattered. And then they don't exist anymore. So Goose gander, all that stuff. So I will show maybe, I'm going to put it this way, nothing's going to happen until I see the tax records first. I want to see the tax releases. I want to see if they exist. And then I probably want to see the birth certificate.
And then I want to know how the trial goes.
That's right.
Because in his first month as president, there'll be a scam college trial that our new quote-unquote president's involved with.
I want all the depositions from all the divorces released. I want to see it all.
I want all raw footage from Celebrity Apprentice released.
Exactly. I want to see all the raw footage. I want to see every minute of that raw footage from...
Gotta vet him.
Gotta vet him.
He wasn't vetted the first time.
Vetted.
He wasn't fully vetted.
We don't know. We don't know. We don't know. I want to see all the vetting. I want to see all the records of all the lawsuits that have been settled before any of that. I mean, I've got a whole long list of this stuff.
Yep. And everyone with platforms needs to be this aggressive and disrespectful because there needs to be some strength in numbers in this. Frankly,
I mean, I think so. Now, here's the deal. And I just got reminded of this the other day by a producer emeritus of the Majority Report. The name Majority Report was, like most things I do, half a joke and half not a joke. And
that could be your autobiography for
honestly,
sure.
Exactly. Like you can't quite tell, and I don't even know either.
I couldn't say myself.
The first Majority Report I ever did was, some of you know, Tom Sharpling, who back in 2003, and he must have been doing it for, he'd been doing it for a while. I used to do some, I would call in and do some bits on his show. And in 2003, in February of 2003, he gave me 2 hours of the best show on FMU to do the Majority Report, just because I was very angry about going to war, and I think he was too. And I don't know how we decided I would do that, but I went out to New Jersey, and John Benjamin came and did a live intro. And frankly, I remember after doing those 2 hours, that Janine was a guest on the show. She called in. I remember after doing those 2 hours, afraid to leave the building because we got some calls. Because at that time things were a little bit scary and we can talk about this later, but I got reminded of that time, of that scariness, to speak out and say certain things over the past couple of days. Nevertheless, the point of the name The Majority Report at the time was, one, to just be in people's faces, because that was, this is a time where there was no liberal talk radio, certainly not on a national level, certainly nothing on television. You weren't allowed to go on television with this stuff. And it was basically in reference to the fact that the majority of the American public had voted for Al Gore. 500,000 more people had voted for Al Gore than George Bush. Yet George Bush became the president because the Supreme Court decided to award him Florida's electoral votes. In this instance, the Supreme Court did not intercede and award Donald Trump any electoral votes, but that same dynamic exists. The majority of Americans who voted for Hillary Clinton or voted against Donald Trump. Both those things are true. A little more voted against Donald Trump than voted for Hillary Clinton. And so understand every time we say the Majority Report, that is a reminder that this program, and certainly all are welcome to listen, but this program articulates positions that are specifically contrary to Donald Trump and representing at least some of the ideas as to why the majority of Americans voted against Donald Trump. What's old is new again, I guess. And folks, unlike 16 years ago, I now own a suit. And I got it from Indochino. What? Indochino?
Yeah, it's fine.
Oh.
Indochina.
All right. I don't know. I got the suit. I don't go around saying the word. Yeah, okay. So, unlike 16 years ago, I now have a suit. And I got it from Indochino. And I got to tell you that I look good. It's actually a three-piece suit. I don't have a lot of occasions to wear it, but I wear it around the house, and it's impressive to everybody there. Mila likes it because she always complains when she's like, you should go to work every day like that. And I said, well, I can't. I'm not going to, but it does look good. And I'm literally waiting for like some event to go out to or to some place to wear it.
All dressed up with no place to go.
Yes. But let me tell you how it works. Okay, there's two ways to do this. One is you can visit an Indochino.com or you can drop by one of their 9 North American showrooms. They're a Canadian company, so that's why they North American. You pick from hundreds of fabrics and patterns. You choose your customizations, like you can have a wider lapel or the thing that goes out here. It's sophisticated. It's, I mean, this is the beauty of it. Even for someone like myself, who is not a sophisticated dresser, you go there and you get the options and they walk you through it. And I even, you know, like I sort of had to pretend like I knew what I was talking about.
Oh, but that's a lapel.
You can decide to have pleats on your pants or not. I went without the pleats. I know better. You can get jacket linings. There's all you get to choose. Basically, all of it can be customized, and you submit your body measurements. Like I said, either through the website, and they take you through the whole thing where you measure, or you're in person. You kick back, you relax, get ready to step into the best, most stylish suit you've ever worn in just 4 weeks. This week's my listeners can get any premium Indochino suit for just $389 at Indochino.com when entering majority at checkout. That's 50% off the regular price for a made-to-measure premium suit. Plus, the shipping is free. It's Indochino.com, promo code majority for any premium suit for just $389 and free shipping. You'll never have to worry about badly fitting suits or expensive trips to the tailor again. Get ready to look like $1 million. I got angry last night on Hayes, and maybe we should have even played that. I don't know. Maybe we could clip it, but I basically, the more I got talking about it, the more angry I got about it being time for new leadership in the Democratic Party. And, I mean, I think we've talked about I've certainly complained about how Clinton did not attempt to tie Trump around Paul Ryan's neck. And when Chuck Schumer and Bill Clinton had hinted at this tax repatriation deal that they were going to do with Ryan, you know, that gives you a sense of why they might have wanted to spare Ryan, right? This is the deal. We can deal with him. And the idea that we were told was it's going to attract reasonable Republican, college-educated Republicans. And they turned out to, for the most part, all vote for Trump anyways. And so, you know, that's the calculation. It was their calculation to make, but they were wrong. And it's hard to understand how much worse they could fail. There is no way to understand how they could fail worse. They failed. And like I said on Hayes, they are O for everything. State houses, governorships, Senate, House, presidency, new leadership. And we'll talk to Adam Green about this in a bit. But Bernie Sanders is now advocating Keith Ellison for for chair of the DNC. Amen. And there's a petition going around. We'll put that on the site.
Yeah, I'll find that.
In the meantime, we are getting close to the holidays. And
enjoy.
Enjoy. It should be really fun at Thanksgiving with your relatives. We're going to try and get Janine in here. I'm going to try. I don't know. She's out in LA. I'm going to try and get her in here for our annual Thanksgiving thing. We need it this year bad. But with that said, holidays are fast approaching. You could order gifts for everyone on your list with a click of a mouse. Get the perfect gift and avoid the malls, the lines, the crowds. If you're looking for the perfect gift, let me tell you about the Omaha Steaks and how for only $49.99, you can get the family gift pack when you go to omahasteaks.com and enter my code REPORT in the search bar. That's 77% off. Now, we had these around Father's Day, right? You get a great steak experience at home. Most flavorful, tender aged beef. They have seafood, poultry, pork, lamb, veggies, desserts, appetizers, pasta, soup. They have over 500 gourmet gift ideas, highest quality cuts and ingredients, aged for 21 days, hand-trimmed, vacuum-sealed. Right now, Omaha Steaks is giving exclusive savings just to my listeners. Listen to everything you get for less than $50. Two filet mignons, top sirloins, two boneless pork chops, four boneless chicken breasts, four kielbasa sausages, four burgers, 12 ounces of package of all beef meatballs, four potatoes au gratin, four caramel apple tartlets. I did not have those. Just trying to say, I've got to watch out for stuff like that because it's too sweet for me. I'll eat all four in one sitting. One Omaha Steak seasoning packet, plus get four additional kielbasa sausages free. Go to omahasteaks.com, enter my code REPORT in the search bar, add the family gift pack, pack to your cart, and get 77% savings. It's the gift guaranteed to be a hit. All right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, Adam Green. We are back. Sam Cedar on the Majority Report on the phone. It is always a pleasure to welcome back to the program the co-founder of the Progressive Change Campaign Committee at boldprogressives.org. It's always a pleasure to welcome Adam Green to the program. This, of course, the context not as we would have hoped when we talked about doing this segment last week. Is it, Adam?
It's a true statement.
Oh, I'm sorry. Hold on. Let me go ahead.
That is a true statement, Sam Cedar.
It is a true statement. Thank you, Adam. All right. Let's talk about, I mean, look, there's going to be a, there's going to be a lot of suffering in this country because of the election of Donald Trump, I suspect. And, you know, also loss of control, or I should say inability to control the Senate. There's also, you know, an immediate reaction, I think, from a lot of people who rightly perceive themselves very vulnerable when a guy like Donald Trump gets into office, and a fear on their part. But for a moment, let's just talk about this, because, you know, I hadn't contemplated, frankly, a Trump victory. And for people like yourself, I mean, I feel this, too, in terms of the way that I look at this program. I'm on email lists with people who work in policy and have been writing up policy papers, you know, ranging from, you know, expansion of transgender rights to, you know, fixing the Affordable Care Act. And they basically realize, like, all the work they've been doing on this for years is meaningless mm-hmm. now. You must have had some similar experience where all of the plans that you had anticipated are radically different now.
That is another true fact. So, you know, we've talked numerous times the last couple of years about, you know, a fairly thorough game plan that, you know, we at the Progressive Change Campaign Committee had in collaboration with a lot of others, which was meticulously moving big progressive Elizabeth Warren style ideas like debt-free college, like expand Social Security, like Wall Street reform, and the public option more recently down the court into the center of the mainstream conversation onto the presidential, you know, ticket and platform so that we could have a progressive governing moment in 2017. And, you know, winning the election, the presidential election was about to be the opening firing shot of the race. And there was going to be a lot of, you know, nothing was a foregone conclusion, but we were getting positioned to have that possibility of a moment. And now I think we all need to just acknowledge that the next several years of our lives will be dramatically different. And, you know, one thing I would also kind of stipulate as a fact is that nobody's got a game plan right now. You know, I think probably people like yourself, people like us, have a leg up because we are tethered to a set of principles and kind of a fighting mentality that allows us to kind of not be as shell-shocked in this moment as raw political actors who only operate as political tacticians and just had their entire boat knocked over. But still, everybody is starting from scratch and having very nascent conversations. I can say that after talking to, you know, numerous Senate offices in the last couple of days, and, you know, a lot of friends in the progressive community and, you know, the Democratic community. So the good news is the progressives can have a real trajectory changing impact right now in this horrible world we're about to enter. And, you know, people like yourself, honestly, are big thought partners in this. And, you know, I really would invite your listeners to tweet at both of us. Mine is at Adam Green with any thoughts or ideas they have, because again, it's not, you know, singing in the wind here. That's the wrong analogy. It's not something in the wind here. It is really, this is a moment that we can have an impact. The one thing I would share beyond that is that after the 2014 elections, we actually saw what's possible in this type of moment. When everybody was shell-shocked, I think we've talked about this, you know, the Progressive Change Institute did this month-long process called the Big Ideas Project, asking the public and lots of progressives to put ideas into the mix and allow the public to vote on them. At the time, we got 32 members of Congress, including Chuck Schumer, including Elizabeth Warren, including 30 others, to commit to looking at the top ideas that bubbled to the top. We then took those ideas, and before we kind of invoked those meetings, we did a very expensive, very thorough poll with a lot of ideas voted on by the public, And that's where things like debt-free college, expand Social Security, a lot of, you know, bread and butter kitchen table issues rose to the top, leading to a lot of the kind of intellectual victories we've had these and political victories we've had this the past couple of years, with some of our ideas moving right into the mainstream. So I think we're, you know, again, based on conversations the last couple of days, we're in that moment again where there is not this, you know, this kind of elite go away mentality towards progressives, but more, you know, somebody's looking for direction and progressives have a chance to lead. So I'll just leave it there for now.
The point being that the establishment of the Democratic Party is certainly on their heels at this point. And so, I mean, so there's a couple of things, right? One is there are questions as to sort of what makes sense to pursue intellectually and in terms of, like, you know, building ideas that exist. Because we should also say that the Republicans, they do, it seems to me, a better job of having, like, all of these, you know, broadly speaking, maybe they more of them do this. Having, like, okay, we've got all these ideas on the shelf here. And part of it is because they're able to implement these on a statewide basis. And so they can, you know, they have, they've done all the intellectual framework for these things. And so they're ready. But I don't think that the Republicans have really fully had you know, had done any game plan here as to, like, what they would do politically with a Donald Trump presidency either. So there's, you know, at the very least, this is the best time to act, it seems to me, politically, but, you know, broadly speaking, or just to, you know, to get out of to get out of the gate quickly. And so aside from in terms of ideas, like, strategically, you know, more broadly than the idea what particular things to push for, what are you guys thinking about, you know, in terms of strategically, like, where you know, I see that Move On has put out a petition and Bernie Sanders called for Keith Ellison to be the head of the DNC. Is that, like, is that the first thing to get control or to get more influence with the Democratic Party leadership?
So again, with the caveat that this is all very nascent thinking, yes, you know, I think that Keith Ellison at the head of the DNC would actually be a tangible, you know, potential game changer for building longer term progressive power, right? The DNC has, you know, pretty much been the bastion of the establishment, the bastion of tactics, not strategy, you know, sometimes useful tactics, but to, you know, build on the work that Howard Dean started and do it in an even more ideological way. With Keith Ellison, who's the chair of the Congressional Progressive Caucus, and equally important, is a genuine partner to progressive movement actors, right? Not just being an ideological progressive, but being a strategic movement partner is key if we really want to leverage the resources and structure of the Democratic Party, like the literal Democratic Party, to our advantage. So that would be a big one, but it's definitely not the totality of it. I mean, that's really an opening move. You know, some tensions that we're thinking about, you know, I'm just calling this, for lack of a better word, the broken clock dynamic, right? Mm-hmm. Trump will accidentally be, you know, inclined towards positions we agree with on a couple issues, right? Whether it's the TPP or, you know, if he actually makes good on any of the kind of corporate establishment, you know, animus that he's drummed up, along with all the other animus that he's drummed up, which is more, you know, hateful. You know, if there will be some tensions between Paul Ryan and Trump, if Trump is at all the way as president that he was as a candidate. And I don't think it's an accident that Paul Ryan's talking point right now, as they scurry to figure out what to do, is talking about how we will have a unified Republican government, right? That's to Paul Ryan's advantage, given that tax bills come out of the House, right? Like, the more that Republicans are talking about Republican unified government, when Paul Ryan is the genesis of Republican policies in the House, like, that benefits him. The more that there's a wedge between him and Trump, that can accidentally serve progressives. But how do we deal with that in a way that doesn't legitimize him as normal? He's not normal, right? He is a very destructive force. And this is going to be a key thing. We, like, the collective we, including the Democratic Party establishment need to figure out. And
let me articulate that in a different way, which is the Republicans, when Barack Obama came into office, they said, we will obstruct everything. We will never give him a win. And they held that line, even if it was Barack Obama offering them everything they ever asked for. I mean, that's a little bit of an exaggeration, but, you know, they were looking for cuts to Social Security. He put it on the table. No, just like blanket. No, we're just not going to do it. And so that's one option. The other option, like you say, is to sort of, you know, because Barack Obama did not have both the Senate and the House control. And so the idea
he
of
did.
Well,
he
did. You did. I'm sorry,
years.
For the first 2 years. And so the idea of and certainly wasn't looking towards it, you know, in the out years in the way that I think like people project the Republicans will hold the House and the Senate. So the dynamic's a little bit different there. And the idea of a cleave between Obama and, let's say, Nancy Pelosi or Harry Reid, not as obvious of a play, you know, I'm guessing. But so that's just another I'm just trying to delineate the different options of agreeing with Trump when it's something good we want. And because and that's basically what Bernie Sanders said. Right. He said, if Donald Trump proposes infrastructure, great. I'll be with him on that. Everything else he does that I don't like, we won't
right.
be.
Right.
And so, all right. So the other question, I guess, is I'm starting to hear that what the Republicans are going to do is very early on, maybe as early as late January, early February. They are going to essentially dismantle the Affordable Care Act through reconciliation, which is a process which can't be, which is basically an unfettered process. You can't put amendments on the bill. You can't filibuster it by the Democrats. It's a simple majority situation in both houses. It would probably be, we're basically setting the clock. It will go, be phased out in 2019. Right after the midterms, what is your sense of like what the messaging should be there? What should Democrats be doing? I mean, if they had an opportunity to filibuster, should they do that, or should they just simply let the Republicans go ahead with this because it's inevitable anyways? I mean, what or are we not even there yet in calculating that?
I personally am not even there yet. you know, my general inclination is that. If there is a filibuster possibility, like when obstruction matches our ideology, it just seems like we should do it, right? Like the tension is when, you know, filibustering does not match it. Like you said, like if he's proposing infrastructure, what do we do, right? So in that case, yes. And if they manage to repeal Obamacare in a real way through reconciliation, God, that'll be quite a lesson for Democrats because progressives were urging the entirety of Obamacare that they get around the Joe Liebermans of the world and the Republicans who are obstructionists by just passing it for reconciliation. And there were all these excuses to not do that. And my understanding at the time, based on their talking points, was there's a very narrow scope of budget-related items that can do reconciliation, but you couldn't do the full kahuna through that process, so we had to go the real route. You know, I'd be curious why we could do the full kahuna of repeal through that route.
Right.
But again, I have explored this in no real way so far, but we'll see. I mean, we got, you know, as much as Obamacare is flawed, you know, like that'd be horrible with the direction of the country if they were able to do that.
I think it would be incredibly disastrous, I think, as opposed to fixing it. I mean, you would immediately, millions of people would lose their health insurance. I mean, who knows what they're thinking about replacing it? They've had quite a while to come up with plans, and I don't think they actually have one, to be honest with you. All right.
So,
go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, so there's one other dynamic that I just want to put out there that we're thinking about that, again, I invite all comers when it comes to adding to the mix. And my guess is that every element of the Democratic Party, including, you know, our progressive element, will be thinking about this question of, you know, what truly motivated Trump voters. And to the extent that the answer is that Donald Trump manage to tap into their very real, economic and social anxiety and their anger and channel it in his horrible direction. What is our solution about how to acknowledge, you know, the real economic pain that a lot of people are feeling and some of the unfortunate social consequences that come from that pain, including the proclivity in some quarters to blame the other, right? How do we acknowledge that the pain exists, even if we don't like all the ramifications of it or manifestations of it, and channel it in a more productive direction, right? What's the difference? He definitely, I would encourage everybody, and I'll send you a link, Sam, and you can post it on your website if you want, to watch the final 2-minute closing argument ad that Donald Trump had. 75% of it could have been a Bernie Sanders ad. It was
right.
It was amazing. It was anti-corporate establishment. It was anti-political establishment. And then it had some xenophobia mixed in, right?
Yeah, vague anti-Semitic overtones.
Yeah.
And let me reinforce your point here. There's a reporter, and his name escapes me, but apparently he was on a call did a tweet storm on this yesterday. I think it was, with the Trump campaign pollster type of people. And apparently on October 4th, the campaign thought they were dead. They were within three in two swing states. After the Comey stuff, they didn't say Comey stuff, but it happened to be after the Comey stuff, they started to see that there was some loosening and some basically undecideds in some rural areas, and they targeted them with this closing argument stuff. And this is what they believe pushed them over the edge, because we're not talking like a huge bump for Trump. I mean, and that's the other thing. But I want to get to that. But I just wanted to say, like, that's how they targeted specific people with that ad. I mean, like I say, it's a 2-minute ad. It's not like something that they're putting on broadcast television. They're targeting people with it. And in that broadly speaking, that message. Let me ask you this. And we're not clear yet. I mean, everybody's got a different hypothesis about the data. I was tweeting with one guy from Pennsylvania on the ground. He said, like, there's definitely more white rural voters who came out that normally do not vote. And I've heard that argument. But what is also clear is that Hillary Clinton underperformed Barack Obama's 2012 numbers, which were lower than the 2008 numbers. And presumably there should be even, raw numbers. And presumably there should be more voters. Is it harder to make the argument that from that side of the ledger? In other words, rather than saying, like, what is it that Trump got? How did Trump get just about the same raw votes that Mitt Romney did? Maybe arguably got more of certain types of voters that Mitt Romney did, like, from certain counties that Obama had won. As opposed to, why didn't Hillary Clinton drive the vote in the way that that Barack Obama did with some core constituencies? Because she also clearly lacked any type of economic message by the end of and I'm talking just campaign style. I know what was on her website and I know what her positions were, but there was no attempt to do anything about jobs or anything like that. It was all just, Donald Trump's a moral monster. Is the reason why we rely on this question about how Trump appealed because it makes it easier rhetorically to get to Bernie Sanders' positions? I mean, because I think that I make the argument from the other side. She couldn't even draw out reliable Democratic voters who we're going to need in the off-year elections. Because it seems to me this election cycle looked like an off-year election cycle for Democratic voters. And that was the problem.
Yep. So,
did you hang up?
Yes, I'm here. Yeah, we should think about that side of the ledger. Short answer, yes. On the Clinton messaging, let me just give a little bit of credit. So, again, as someone who worked really hard to get them to not just put progressive positions on a website, but to actively campaign on them you know, it was very notable that within the first minute of the first debate, debt-free college was brought up by her. You know, that it became a staple along with some other progressive themes in her campaign speeches. You know, I do think that they learned a lesson early on that if they're not talking about Trump, the media will not cover them, which feeds right into the kind of media critique of how the media operated with Trump that I'm sure you can explore with many others. But, you know, I think they might have been reacting a little bit there. But part two of that is that Bernie Sanders offered a more systemic critique,
right,
and a set of villains that, you know, I do think are part of the solution, part of, yeah, for Democrats that want to be able to properly channel this voter anxiety in a more productive direction, that the Clinton campaign, for all of their many good positions, did not necessarily undergird with that systemic critique. Right. So we gotta get there. And I do think that that's going to be the place. You know, there's going to be many places where the interests of the progressive movement and the Democratic Party are aligned. But I think that kind of getting to that final place of a systemic critique, which includes taking on corporate campaign donors, right, which includes a lot of things, you know, will be a bit of a source of tension. And we just got to win that one because it's vital.
All right. So here's my last question for you. When we first met, you were like a move on guy, right? Okay. So, and since we're sort of like, you know, coming back around in many respects to this sort of more defensive posture, one of the things that came up last night when I was doing Hayes was this question of a popular front, right? Where at least from my perspective, and maybe it was my naivete at the time, I assumed that I was in a similar ideological space as a lot of people who, upon the election of Barack Obama, I realized, like, oh, wait, no, I'm not. I'm, you know, policy-wise, I'm to the left of them. But we all sounded the same when it was George Bush as the president. How do you, A, form that popular front, but B, maintain the integrity of more progressive positions? And this seems to me a question that I could ask to someone like yourself, who is, I think, like on the progressive end of a Democratic coalition, all the way to the left of, you know, people who have a socialist agenda, a full-on socialist agenda, but realize, like, that's not going to be implemented in the short run, and we're not going to have an armed revolution to bring it about. It's going to have to develop. But how, from your perspective, how do you maintain those two things?
Got it. And also, can you just define popular front?
Well, in the sense that there was a lot of allies who were aligned and were then beginning to coordinate who weren't necessarily on the same ideological page, but were all allied to stop certain Bush proposals.
Yep. Yeah. So, you know, again, I think this will ultimately be the question of the day, right? And it incorporates, I think it, you know, really incorporates a lot of the other questions and dynamics we were talking about. You know, I think in the very short term that this exploration of what motivated Trump voters, how can we, you know, what's a plausible theory for rechanneling that anger, you know, in an authentic way, in a way that, you know, is more productive. I think that will be a big tent thing. And I really hope that that allows people to kind of be people that are more Democratic establishment than progressive movement to be more along for the ride on, again, the systemic critique, being willing to challenge corporate power, really addressing, addressing power in general, right? Not just corporate power. And, you know, leading people to water, right? That's my hope, that's part of it. I think we're going to be up against some conventional wisdom. Some of these folks that are up in 2018 in key kind of rural, redder Senate states might feel the need to like sometimes show agreement with Trump if he won their states. And I'm really worried about that. And, you know, I think that, again, we need to provide a counter theory for appealing to Trump's voters without just having agreeing with Trump be the proxy for that. Hmm. That's where I think the tension is going to be. But again, it's all very nascent right now. So I just want to acknowledge that again and right. ask folks to please tweet at both of us. Mine is Adam Green. Are you just Sam Cedar?
Sam Cedar, I think, yeah.
Tweet, please tweet. Let us know what you're thinking. I also would just invite anybody who, you know, appreciates this set of very complicated questions and the progressive attempt to answer them to join us at boldprogressives.org. That is a serious invitation. Our activism the next couple of months will all be geared at, you know, truly constructive answers to a lot of these important questions. So.
Adam, I appreciate you coming on. I know this was, you know, this was not the conversation that we had anticipated, and it's very early and everybody's still in a sort of mild state of shock. Mild may be an understatement.
What was that?
What's that?
What was that voice there?
Oh, that was Michael. I'm sorry.
Hey, what's up, Michael?
How's it going? How you doing? I guess my mic wasn't on.
Good.
Sorry about that. it's nothing. There's no one's in your cell phone yet. It's okay.
Right. That was Chris Christie.
Got
it. He was just checking on you. So I really do appreciate you coming on. I'll talk to you soon. Get some rest.
Sounds great.
All right.
Thank you, Sam.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, folks, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to be talking to Ari Berman of The Nation magazine about the tremendous amount of voter suppression that has been ongoing. But let's get a sense of what it meant in this election. We'll be back in just a moment. We are back. Sam Cedar on the Majority Report on the phone from The Nation magazine, the author of what is it? What's Ari? Give us the ballot, son of a bitch!
Come on, Sam.
It's a best-selling book, a fantastic book, a book on voting rights, perhaps the most. I mean, I don't know of another reporter who has been on this beat, not only as diligently you, but his period has been on this beat for as many years now as you have been on this beat about voter suppression, voting rights, what could and may not now happen in terms of restoring parts of the Voting Rights Act. Ari Berman, welcome to the program.
Thanks, Sam.
So obviously, this is a beat that we had talked over the course of the summer and into the fall as to the status of different voter ID laws and voter suppression tactics that were going on in states that turned out to be, many of them, key states in this in Donald Trump's victory. Give me a sense of what your sense is as to how much voter suppression via voting laws that specifically were implemented following the Supreme Court's gutting of the Voting Rights Act, what kind of impact they had and where?
Sure. So I think they had some impact. We will never, I don't think, know exactly the impact. But I was in Wisconsin on Election Day, which was not directly affected by the Supreme Court's ruling gutting the Voting Rights Act because it was a northern state that was not covered. However, it was one of 14 states that had a new voting restriction in effect for the first time, resulting from stuff that was passed after the 2010 election and then was upheld, unfortunately, by the court. So I was in Wisconsin, and I talked to a number of different voters who either had a very hard time voting or just didn't vote at all because they were turned away from getting a voter ID. And we can never quantify the numbers of people who tried to vote and couldn't or decided not to vote at all. But what we do know is that Wisconsin was very close, that Trump beat Clinton by 27,000 votes in the state. And according to a federal court, 300,000 registered voters in Wisconsin lack strict forms of voter ID. Now, of those 300,000 registered voters, many may have been able to obtain ID. Some may have had alternate forms of ID. But we know that that's a lot of people. That was 9% of the electorate in Wisconsin. And we don't know how many of them decided not to vote for other reasons, how many of them decided not to vote because of this reason, tried to vote and couldn't. We can't quantify all this, but my point was that we needed a lot more people, a lot more people in the media, a lot more people on the ground looking into this. Because if you're not asking the question, you're not going to get the answer. So what I observed on Election Day was, I was with two people who made multiple trips to the polls and talked to another couple who didn't vote at all. And so there was at least some people that were having difficulty here. Did it swing the election? I don't know. But it was certainly a factor that didn't get enough coverage.
And we should say in Milwaukee County, turnout was less than was 50,000. It was down 50,000 people from 2012. Now
it was a huge. It was down nearly 15% from 2012. It was one of the largest drops of anywhere in the state, and that's where 70% of the state's African American population lives. Now, who knows? Again, we don't know why people decide not to vote.
Right. It could have been people are just not motivated by Hillary Clinton in the way that they were Barack Obama for a myriad of reasons, running from some people are more motivated to vote for Barack Obama because first African-American president, also a very charismatic guy, hope and change, all that stuff.
Yeah.
Not so much in 2012, hope and change, but still equally charismatic. Or it could have been just like, people had reluctance to go and vote for Hillary Clinton. Who knows?
Sure, there were big drop-ups in states that didn't have these restrictions. There were big drop-offs in Michigan and Pennsylvania that didn't have voter ID laws. But I keep going back to this one study that Rice University did that I mentioned in this piece I wrote about how the GOP war on voting rights was so uncovered. And there was a 2014 study by Rice University of the Texas's 23rd congressional district, which is largely Hispanic and is controlled by Republican. And they found that in 2014, 12.8% of registered voters who didn't vote cited lack of required photo ID as a reason they didn't cast a ballot. Of those 12% who didn't vote because of voter ID, only 2% actually lacked an acceptable ID. So what we know is that the law had a deterrent effect on some people. It prevented others from voting. And when they did this survey, they found that 80% of these people who didn't show up because of voter ID were Latino and would have voted for Democratic candidates. So we don't know if 12% of Wisconsinites decided not to vote because of this. We just know that some people didn't turn out for this reason, and it's something that just needs to be asked. It's something that needs a lot more discussion. And I basically was saying that this has been almost totally ignored.
What does that survey, I mean, what is behind that? I mean, presumably, right, those people with the IDs could have voted. Is it that they're just intimidated? Are they undocumented immigrants and they don't want to show their license and vote? What is it?
Well, there are people who are registered voters. So I think there are people who probably either they legally registered to vote or they had voted in past elections. I think maybe they just thought that the IDs they have wouldn't have been accepted. Maybe they had IDs other than a driver's license they didn't think would have been accepted. Or maybe they were worried that they would be intimidated. I mean, in Texas, there was a lot of extremely intimidating rhetoric going around about people who would be prosecuted and all sorts of other things if they didn't show the right ID. So the point is that even if people can comply with the law, sometimes it just has a deterrent effect and people don't want to go through the hassle. Some people are just barred from voting. They're not going to have the documents they need to be able to vote. Other people, they may be able to, but they just don't want to go through the hassle. One of the things we saw in North Carolina, for example, which was subject to Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act, was they eliminated a lot of polling places.
Yes.
in black areas during the first week of early voting. In places like Greensboro, there were something like 22 early voting sites in 2012 during the first week of early voting, and only one early voting site for the first week of early voting in 2016. And black turnout decreased 16% during the first week of early voting. And then it increased significantly later. So it wasn't just that people were demobilized, because we know that they voted in large numbers later. It was that the fact that voting was so much more inconvenient, there was only one location, that there were 3 to 4 hour lines, seemed to have an impact. So I think, you know, when you make voting more inconvenient, fewer people usually decide to vote.
I think it was on Monday we spoke to my buddy Jack Hitt, who was down in North Carolina doing Get Out the Vote stuff, and he ran into a lot of people who were like, yeah, there used to be a voting place down here by the church, and now I don't know where it's gone now. And, you know, getting 2 miles away, if you don't have a car, becomes difficult. Or if it's not there in that first week of early voting, people presume it's not there in the second week. They don't know.
Yeah, I mean, they don't know. Exactly.
I mean, it seems to me the agenda is there's from a voter suppression strategy, just having controversy around the vote gives you some value in terms of suppressing the vote, right? Like, you don't even need just the idea of like, oh, there's new requirements. Oh, it's going to be a hassle.
And I think a lot of Trump's rhetoric about voter intimidation that's what it was aimed at. That the campaign was never organized enough to actually have people, quote unquote, watching the polls all around, but they created a sense of fear that meant that people might be challenged and groups like the KKK might be out there in force. And that could have had a suppressive effect. But you're right. I mean, people that are really hardcore, that really wanted to vote, would have waited in the lines, would have found the polling place, even if there was only one, or would have voted the next week when there are more polling places. But people who were already kind of on the fence, who may have voted for Obama but may not have been crazy for Clinton, and clearly there were a lot of those people, they may have just decided to hell with it. Like, why am I going to bother if I have to wait in a long line or I have to get a new ID if I'm not really that crazy about that person to begin with? And so I think it's a big problem. I mean, turnout was still down in states like Minnesota that made it easy to vote. But at the same time, I think in states where it was more inconvenient, like North Carolina or like in Wisconsin, there's certainly a drop in turnout that can't be ignored.
All right. So let's get to the broader question here. You know, we had talked many times over the past couple of years about the chance that Congress would two scenarios. One, that Congress would actually be able to get its act together, and I don't even want to frame it that way, that Republicans would be willing to fix the Voting Rights Act that essentially the Supreme Court had kneecapped by coming up with a new formula for preclearance for those states that were subject to it under the Voting Rights Act as it was reauthorized by the Congress in 2007. The other opportunity was that a Democratic president would appoint a fifth justice, and then perhaps, who knows after that, and the Supreme Court would revisit it based upon what had happened since. Both those things seem to be dead now. Is that right?
Yeah. I mean, I wish I had better news, but they're both dead. I mean, Democrats needed to take back the Senate. They needed to pass a restored Voting Rights Act, and they needed to put a lot of pressure on Paul Ryan, who said he personally supported it, but wouldn't pressure his committee chairman to do anything to try to get this thing passed and then have a Democratic president who would sign it. But that's not happening. Republicans are not going to restore the Voting Rights Act, and certainly not with Trump as president. And then the Supreme Court, I mean, the number one reason why I'm most disappointed in the election result is because of the Supreme Court, that Democrats had a chance to take control of the court for the first time in 50 years. And they completely blew it. And a lot of blame has to go on
Republicans. What do you mean, the first time in 50 years?
Yeah, because there has not been a liberal majority on the court since Earl Warren retired in 1968. So nearly 50 years. There has been the Berger Court, and then the Rehnquist Court, and then the Roberts Court. And recently we were dealing with the 4-4 court, which was better than a 5-4 conservative court, but there was still not a liberal or even a sort of centrist
right.
majority. And so this was a huge, I can't even overstate how big of a missed opportunity this was. And obviously the Republicans who blocked Merrick Garland deserve a lot of blame. But I think, first off, I think President Obama deserves blame for nominating Merrick Garland, who was a totally uninspired choice, who did nothing to motivate the Democratic base. They could have picked someone
nothing.
Who was younger, who was more diverse. And then the Democrat and Hillary never made it an issue. So many evangelicals voted for Trump because of the Supreme Court. But there was no corresponding constituency in the Democratic Party that was motivated by the court that said, we need a court that will restore the Voting Rights Act and overturn Citizens United and all these things that Bernie Sanders talked about during his campaign. It just was totally not part of any of the messaging. Hillary never even talked about it. So I think that this was just such an unbelievable missed opportunity. Now Trump's going to appoint another Scalia to the court.
Yep.
Hopefully Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who should have retired when Democrats had control of the Senate, will hang on. But this is incredibly risky. I mean, at the very least, we're headed towards back to a 5-4 conservative Supreme Court, and we could be headed towards 6-3, and then just forget about it. Everything's gone.
For decades. And I would say not only did Clinton not make it an issue, I share the election was most important for me for those very reasons, too. And the level of ignorance in the progressive movement as to the relevance of the Supreme Court, broadly speaking, but also for almost every issue that they talk about, that we talk about, just a complete disconnect as to the rudimentary role that the Supreme Court played in those issues is, I don't consider it a personal failure, but pretty close.
It was such a systemic failure within the Democratic Party, within the progressive movement. I mean, there were a lot of evangelicals that didn't like Donald Trump personally, but voted for him because of the Supreme Court.
Yep.
I mean, we know that for a fact. Lots of data bears that out. But it just didn't motivate people. I mean, it didn't seem to motivate Democrats who thought about staying home. It didn't seem to motivate people who thought about voting third party, who may have cared about climate change or the right to choose or all these other issues that are coming before the Supreme Court. It didn't seem to motivate young voters who care about things like immigration reform and criminal justice reform that are coming before the court. I mean, the link was... You could either say that the link was made and people just didn't care, or you could say that it just wasn't front and center to begin with. And I don't know if they just worried that making it front and center would motivate Republicans more. But I mean, when Obama had an opportunity to do this and nominated kind of an old centrist white guy,
right,
he really, in my opinion, missed an opportunity to make this a galvanizing issue. What if he had instead chosen a liberal black woman?
Oh,
that would have made it
a front-and-center
issue.
I mean, argument that politically the choice was horrible. I mean, you know, he would have been an upgrade from Scalia. I don't think that the guy was a horrific choice for the Supreme Court. But the issue wasn't that you were going to seat this guy. The issue was, are you going to be able to build public pressure to seat him? And, you know, the
exactly.
argument that somehow this is going to put pressure on Chuck Grassley. What?
It never worked. The fever never broke during Obama's entire presidency.
No.
And the idea that it was going to break over the Supreme Court of all things,
right,
which you can't repeal unlike Obamacare, is just unbelievable. So I think it was a huge missed opportunity. Even with Merrick Garland, though, it should have been a bigger issue. I mean, even if we had a guy who was, you know, 64 and relatively centrist, he would have been such an upgrade over John Roberts and, you know, not to mention Scalia. And immediately, there would have been a 5-4 majority to protect things like voting rights. And,
yeah,
and now we have a Supreme Court that's going to further gut the Voting Rights Act, that's going to further strengthen things like voter ID laws. You can't appeal anything anymore if there's a 5-4 majority. I mean, it's just – so I can't overstate how big of an issue this is, and I'm so concerned about what's going to happen with the courts, not just the Supreme Court, but all the lower courts that are going to hear these cases as well.
Right. Because, of course, the Supreme Court is going to set the tone for these things. All right. You know, Ari, I know we just got a couple of minutes left here. So broadly, let's broaden out a little bit. There was a time that you were not focused on the Voting Rights Act. I think you were a young cub reporter back during the Bush years. I mean, give me your sense of what you think the Democrats need to do in this era of defensiveness, right? I mean, it's a totally different ball game. Give me your sense of Chuck Schumer. Do you think, you know, a lot of people maligned Harry Reid, but I think, from an obstruction standpoint, he was pretty good, you know, in ways that I think were not always public. And I think that's what, you know, I think may have made him good. I don't have even that level of faith with Chuck Schumer. Am I wrong? Do you know?
I don't have a ton of faith in him either. I mean, as a person, but also just, you know, he has a caucus that's going to be pretty unwieldy. He's got, you know, people who are up in 2018, like Heidi Heitkamp from North Dakota, that are representing extremely conservative states where Trump's very popular, Joe Manchin of West Virginia, who are not going to want to vote for the Democrats, who are going to have a lot of Trump supporters lobbying them. So I think it's going to be very hard for him to do the same kind of strategy that Mitch McConnell did. First off, I don't think Democrats are good at message discipline to begin with. But secondly, I think it's going to be very hard for them to hold people online. I think the Democratic Party needs to get back to its base. I mean, Hillary made this entire election about the fact that she was going to win crossover Republican support, and it just
right.
didn't happen.
Right.
She got fewer Republicans voted for Clinton than Democrats voted for Trump. Trump got his base out and then expanded the tent, even though everyone said that he wasn't going to be able to do it. He did it. And Hillary didn't do the opposite. She didn't expand the tent and she didn't get her base out. And it was a mistake to put someone like Tim Kaine on the ticket, who was totally vanilla. It was kind of the same Merrick Garland strategy. They didn't spend nearly enough time with younger voters until it was far too late. So they were just, the DNC was a complete disaster. Yeah. With Debbie Wasserman Schultz, and they just didn't. They had all this enthusiasm in the primary with Bernie Sanders, and they just didn't harness it effectively. And the groups that they needed to get out didn't get out. If she had just gotten out her base, if she had just gotten voter turnout to be equal to 2012 in places like Milwaukee,
right,
then she would have been president.
Yep.
In Detroit, in Flint, and all of these places, she would have been president. She didn't get her own people out. The Democrats didn't get their own people out. And you got to wonder what's going to happen without Obama on the ballot. There have been three elections in the Obama era without Obama on the ballot. And Democrats have lost every single one of them. So I think they got, you know, you either got to figure out what's happening with the coalition. Is it enough to try to court younger voters and voters of color and well-educated whites? If you do that, you need a huge turnout. Otherwise, you got to figure out how to get other people to vote for you, which, you know, Hillary was not able to do. Maybe Bernie would have been able to do it. We don't know. But Hillary certainly didn't do it. So I think the party needs to just a total rethink at this point, because they completely – they didn't just lose an election to someone they should have beat, but they lost states like Wisconsin and Michigan and Pennsylvania that they haven't lost for decades. I mean, right. This is such a disaster.
Yeah. Well, Ari, this has been very cheery.
Can I say one last thing?
Yeah, please do. I mean, look, everybody's depressed, and it's important that we go through. We talk about this stuff. It's depressing, but it's really important that we go through. And there's a strong understanding. I mean, I think that the entire Democratic leadership now, you know, needs to go. And it's obviously it's not all going to, but I think the more awareness and understanding and reasoned, thoughtful discussion about it, the stronger the case can be made.
Yeah. So the one hopeful note I was going to end on is, you know, while the presidency, while the Congress, while the courts are all going to be under conservative control, I mean, there are some states. There are some blue states that are doing interesting things. Like, this was the first election that Oregon had its automatic registration system in place. And 250,000 people are going to be added to the voting – were added to the voting rolls there. And voter turnout in Oregon was 75%. Very, very high, because they, you know, they're vote by mail. They mailed a ballot to everyone, and they increased the number of people on the voting roll. So I think we need to start there. The blue states need to become these laboratories for reform. And it's going to take a long time for that to translate to places like Ohio or Missouri or wherever. But, you know, when Republicans were marginalized, I mean, it wasn't that long ago when Republicans were marginalized and Democrats controlled lots of stuff. They started pushing for policies that, you know, they would succeed 30 years later. They had a very, very long strategy for the change they wanted to create. And they started with their base, and they worked outward. So I think it's really important that we not just lose sight of what other states are doing, and that, you know, places like Oregon and California, the few places that are under progressive control, can hopefully become blueprints for other states and other places where hopefully in 2018 or 2020 or wherever the political dynamics will change.
Ari Berman, always a pleasure. We'll talk soon.
Thanks a lot, Sam. Thanks, appreciate Ari. It.
All right, folks. I think we're going to take a break here. Well, you know what? Screw it. We're not going to do a we'll do another freebie. It's all free this week. Screw it.
Of the majority.
Yeah, starting
report.
The exactly. But what I'd like to do, because it occurs to me, you know, as I am having difficulty just even contemplating the notion that this guy's our president. I mean, like, you wake up in the morning, it's like, is it possible? Like, what? And I think that's a shared sentiment. So we're going to probably need to develop some music for something like this, maybe even a graphic package, because I think this is going to be a reoccurring segment
could even be a daily segment. And so for today, I'll just use the fanfare. But in future, we're going to need like a full production package for something like this. So I give you now our first installment of, and we're probably even going to have to work on the name, but...
Not my president, your president.
I was going to say, you're, it's got to be something like your moment of nausea for the day. Here it
that
is.
Hits a little too close to home.
Thank you. Here's a good rule. Don't answer the questions when they just start.
It's always the last one.
Come on, guys. Yeah, come on, guys. Let's go.
Very good man.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate you.
There you go. There's Donald Trump calling President Obama a very good man as they are taking questions from the press. I'll give everyone a moment to vomit in their mouth.
Someone on Twitter, I don't have it in front of me, so I don't remember. I'm neglecting the name, unfortunately. But they said that it's sort of a distillation of being black in America, that Obama needs to like, let's sit down. I'll be totally cordial and respectful to you. Yeah, even as your whole career is built on delegitimizing me as a person, human being, not to mention president.
These reasonable Republicans are going to give him a lot of credit for being so gracious, I think.
Yeah. Well, right. I look forward to getting no such credit.
So that is your moment of nausea. Is that a good name? Is that a good
name? I think so.
Daily moment of nausea. It's not inconceivable. We could have days where there's like multiple moments of nausea.
I was going to say, I think that's the trouble with the segment is it's like your life of nausea.
Right.
It's like how we have
now let's move on to something that's going to make you really sick after the moment of nausea. So let's go down the line for potential cabinet picks. Here's the dilemma that I'm facing just from a show producer standpoint. Like, I haven't fully absorbed this stuff, but I think that I want to be conscious of what everybody's going through and the sort of different people come to a different level of acceptance. I mean, me, what I'm doing is I'm picking Twitter fights with some of the lamest trolls.
We all go back to our comfort zones.
Exactly. like literally, it's like, I mean, it's sort of like a demented, sad, sort of like vice that I have.
That may be so. Would you read the one, though, that you had subtweeting Reason? That was really a tour de force.
What was it?
You basically, Reason, being the scumbags that they are, wrote some here's why political correctness led to this, or this is what you need to know. Oh, okay, I'll just read it. This is Catherine Rampel, I guess, from Reason. How Trump...
No, she's not from Reason.
Oh, she's not from... Oh, she's, I don't know who she is.
I think she was probably mocking...
Oh, she was... I apologize profusely. Anyways, her tweet is, how Trump profited from the backlash against quote-unquote
political... But it's not her tweet. She's just tweeting out the...
She's tweeting
the
out the Reason article.
Right.
So Reason tweeted out. Yes. I'll just try to keep her out of it. Sorry. How the backlash against quote-unquote political correctness... How Trump profited from the backlash against political correctness by Reason. And you subtweeted it. Next up, how liberals inspired Jim Quo by insisting on the 13th Amendment. That really was your finest internet.
That's not what I'm talking about.
This is non-troll. Right, this is right, you being quite right. Productive. I was trying to move you in a more elevated direction.
No, I want
to
talk about this troll thing.
Because
it's like a perversion that I have. It's like my perversion. Like, I just wait for some really bad troll to troll me. And one came at me last night, and I'm just like,
messing with the guy. And at one point he goes like, I'm really getting under your skin. And I'm just like, you have absolutely no idea. Like it's just, you don't understand.
This is what I love.
This is like,
this is the best moment I've had in
this
days.
Would be like if I had a problem with drinking and you came by and like, I know you must hate the taste of tequila right now. And I'm just going like, gug, gug, gug. And then I realized, like, the guy, he's getting, you know, there's a picture of a young guy, and it's like an anonymous account. I think it was like talk radio critic or something. And that's probably why I clicked on it. I was like, a talk radio critic.
Talk radio critic.
But there was no name. Like, his real name was like
Talk Radio Critic the Third.
Or something like that. Exactly. And it was a picture of like a young guy, you know, wearing sunglasses in front of a microphone. And
what?
And then I'm like, is he a real talk radio critic? Like, is that even?
Like, I love it. I feel like how you're, my first thought is like, that's not a real thing.
Well, no,
is
like,
he a real one?
No, but it's like, well, it was fascinating. It's like, who's a talk radio critic anymore? Like, that's like being like, I'm a Telegraph critic.
I'm a Pullman Porter, say.
Yeah, exactly. And so I look, and the guy's got like, I don't know, like 900 followers, and he's following like 1,300 people, which is, you know, if that balance is out of whack, it's like, because he's tweeting at me
sad.
Like, he's tweeting at me like, I'm a, his like bio is like, I'm a professional critic, and I call it like I see it or something. And I was just like, this is weird. So, of course, like, I'm like, all right, this is the guy I'm going to engage in. So, and so I start, you know, going back and forth with him. And he's immediately starts getting in this, like, whole thing, like, it sounds like the voice we go, like, little Sammy Cedar sitting in Brooklyn. Oh, you must be very excited because you're on TV. Your mommy sitting around with the Yentas in Boynton Beach, Florida.
I might be giving him too much credit. This actually sounds pretty funny.
Well, no. Your mommy sitting around with Yentas in Boynton Beach, Florida. You know, oh, my son is on there, but I'm mad he's not a doctor or a lawyer. And so
verbatim quote, by the way.
Yeah, something like this. And so I'm like, oh, this guy is just like some type of, you know, just run-of-the-mill, young, anti-Semite, Trump guy. And then I start to realize, he starts going like, you're a Shamil or a Shamazel. And I'm like, you know, and of course I go like, oh, it's like Laverne and Shirley. I get it. And I start to realize like, no, this is like some like guy in his 60s who's not a young guy. Because the first thing he tweeted at me was like, I am smarter, more handsome, wealthier, more successful than you. And then he said like, and I went to a better university than you did. And I'm like,
why do you do that? Why do you set up a sock puppet for that, man?
But who, like, I'm like looking at like, you know, like, I'm looking at this picture and I'm thinking, like, you weren't even born when I was at university. Like, what a weird thing to say to someone who, like, it's like, what did you get in AP biology, man? I bet you got a little greater than me. And I'm just thinking, like, who thinks like this? And I think it's either, like, I feel
I
like
was old
like,
enough to oppose the civil rights movement when it was actually happening.
I feel like it was, like, some 67-year-old guy from like maybe from either from Germany, but he's like, it's like some 67-year-old Jew who, you know, because like some 25-year-old Trump fan doesn't know like that my relatives would be in Boynton Beach, right? Like
I know your relatives, you're in Boynton Beach, man.
Right, you're in Boynton Beach, aren't you? Right, I could just tell.
I'm an anthropologist with the Trump campaign.
The Trump Anthropology Department at Trump University.
Yeah, that's the only real department. It's like, this is where the Jews congregate for retirement. This is where the blacks go.
I'm going back and forth with this guy who's like in his like mid-60s and just trolling me. And then he starts like doing the thing like, it's not a subtweet what you were talking about. That's a quoted tweet.
Quoted tweet.
Subtweet is when you write up, talk about somebody, but don't actually put their handle in there.
Ah.
That's a subtweet.
Right, right, right. You're right, you're right.
And so he's doing the quoted tweet to all 900 of his followers to show, like, look at Sam Cedar. He's not even delivering a good bon mot, he wrote. And he says, like, you're no Oscar Wilde. And I'm thinking, like, what the hell is going on? Trump troll is this who's saying, like, you're no Oscar Wilde, buddy. And I'm just like, and he's going, you
could you honestly picture him writing an Oscar Wilde novel?
But it was just bizarre.
I mean, honestly.
He at one point, he called me Faye. And I'm like,
when you're right, you're right.
Here he is, a Trump. He's like this Trump troll who's now criticizing me because I don't have witty bon mots.
He's the gay Trump
and
department.
I'm not.
It's bon mot, too.
Bon mot. Excuse me.
You have some bon mot over there.
I think I just smoked him out. And I'm just like, this is the most bizarre thing. It's what hit me. Like, this is like a, maybe like a 65-year-old Jewish gay man who is, like, you know, trolling me on behalf of Trump. And it was just bizarre. And then I just got bored with it at that point. I just got bored with it. Just like, and that's right. And then I just tweeted back, Dad, stop smothering me. It was just very strange. Just to give you a sense of my, so I don't know where I was going with that. Oh, okay, so.
It was the highlight of your week.
It was the highlight of my week. So, you know, sir.
Sorry, may I add one thing?
Yeah.
Phoenix Art says with those references, it was probably Dennis Miller.
It would. I feel like it would have been. They would. He would have drawn the lines, right? Like it would have been like, you're like Oscar Wilde's dumb cousin. From
you're no Oscar Wilde on the holodeck, if you know what I'm saying, Ben.
This probably is good news
you're
for
more
Dennis
Miller's
career.
You're more like Oscar Wilde if he was a treble.
That's actually pretty good.
What's that?
With the last fake Dennis Miller line. You're like Oscar Wilde if he was a dribble.
A treble.
A treble.
You know, the trebles from on the Star Trek.
I actually don't know that one. It sounds funny.
Those are the, like the little furry balls that kept like they would basically they would have. They were like bunnies. They kept reproducing constantly. So all of a sudden, like you'd open up a compartment and the whole like the whole enterprise became just overrun with tribbles.
So what's happening in the country?
That's right. So let's deal with this. A lot of what we're going to see in the next couple of months is going to be Donald Trump and the Republican Party trying to give an off-ramp to their most rabid followers so that they don't have to take responsibility for not delivering on the things that they can't deliver on. Now, this is not to say that Donald Trump's going to be reasonable, blah, blah, blah. No, it's not to say that at all. It's to say that, like, they have some problems executing these things. I mean, even just like everything that they were supposed to do on day one would have to be like a 15,000 long hour day. So one of those things is like they may, you know, they're going to end Obamacare, but it's not going to happen for 3 years or something. That's going to happen in January or February, like I say, through reconciliation. Here is Rudy Giuliani, who is sent out there to deal with, and he could very well be the next attorney general, ladies and gentlemen, to deal with Donald Trump's promise to have his next attorney general indict Hillary Clinton. So how do you deal with that? Well, what you do if you're Rudy Giuliani is you create a straw man that you hope will actually happen for some reason.
Rudy, the Clinton Foundation is under investigation, as you know. Should President Obama, before he leaves, should he pardon her? If not, should Donald Trump?
Well, you know, the reality is we have two traditions, right, that are sort of in conflict with each other. One is we try to get over the anger and all everything else about an election after it's over and put it behind us. And I don't like to see America become a country in which we we prosecute people, you know, about politics. On the other hand, there are deep and disturbing issues there in which if you don't investigate them,
they're going to continue.
Yeah, and also it's hard to investigate other people. What do you say to a foundation that where you have a fraud of $50,000,
mm-hmm.
when you haven't looked at a foundation where there is an alleged fraud in the millions or hundreds of millions of dollars? Now, it may be true, it's not true, but it hasn't been investigated.
Yeah, so, and justice for all.
That's a very tough balance, and that's why I don't think President Obama should pardon her. I think President Obama should leave it to the system we all believe in to determine, is she innocent or is she guilty?
It'll be.
Yeah, there it is. So there's an investigation ongoing. I'll just give you all the information you just learned there. There's an investigation ongoing. But Rudy also believes that there needs to be an investigation started because there's allegations. So there's both an investigation and not an investigation. And Barack Obama may pardon her for something that is not being investigated or is being investigated. But he shouldn't pardon her in this way. I mean, I think Rudy Giuliani is basically saying, like, you know, President Obama should pardon her. So that when I become Attorney General, I don't have to maintain my promise or Donald Trump's promise.
We would really like to be focused on overall the criminalization of people of color and systemic harassment and abuse. So I don't necessarily know we're going to have time to try to put our former presidential rival in jail.
Unbelievable. So this is funny. You remember Glenn Beck?
Yeah.
Glenn Beck was on a... You know, we spoke to Adam Green earlier from the PCCC. This is a group that was anticipating how they would push Hillary Clinton to the left. Of course, he's have to go back to the drawing board and reorient everything. Well, there's a lot of people having to do that who had anticipated a certain outcome in this election, had begun to lay the plans on how they would operate under this presidency, and are having to do a U-turn. Here is one guy who was making plans for a Clinton presidency and trying to set himself up as having opposed Donald Trump.
But you have called him a pathological liar, possibly a sociopath. What's the indication that he's a sociopath?
Have you seen him during the last year and a half truly feel for someone that couldn't help him? Truly connect on a human level and say, this has made me stop. This has made me think. This is, you know, I'm deeply sorry for what I have said.
So that's Glenn Beck performing his piece called Donald Trump is a Sociopath, but I actually am a thoughtful person, which he performs by pausing. And furrowing his brow and asking if Charlie Rose could see Donald Trump feel something like the way that Charlie Rose is seeing Glenn Beck feel something. Well, here's Glenn Beck doing the U-turn yesterday on the Glenn Beck program.
An incredible and great movement.
So you should reach out back to him.
I am reaching out today. I will call him today, whether he takes my call or, you know, and I'm not saying that he's going to shun it. I mean, he's now the president-elect. He's a little busy.
Maybe a tad busy.
Yeah, might be a tad busy. But I will call him today. And if I don't get a hold of him, I will write a letter and I will even post the letter so you can read it. And I will reach out to him today. He has our support, as I said from the beginning. We will give whoever is president our support. That would have gone for Hillary Clinton as well. I won't sell out my values, but I will support you. We cannot have a failed presidency. And anyone who says they want to be the president of all people, I'm there.
That's what
this
he said.
This is the very first time he has said that. Yeah. He has said before he doesn't need us, doesn't need our audience or whatever, and that's campaign. He's now the president. We are there. At least I am there. Yeah. This show is there.
So, the sociopath, he's there. He's not going to sell out his principles, which include supporting a sociopath, apparently.
Can I just say something that I never thought would come out of my mouth? But I realize now, actually, it might several times over the next couple of weeks. I really sincerely hope that Glenn Beck does not make it off of the Omarosa enemies list.
Is he on the Omarosa's enemy list?
We don't know who's on the Omarosa. I would assume so.
Do we not know? Do they not post that? Don't they post that on their Facebook page?
That would be funny if under Trump, there's like instead of the president's daily schedule, there's the president's daily enemy list.
I was thinking about that.
This is who I'm not happy with today.
If FOIA manages to survive a Trump administration, the FOIA requests during that time are going to be very interesting.
Oh, we should put in somebody. We should try and put in a FOIA. I don't think you can do that for like presidential advisors, but that would be awesome. I don't know. Here's the question. Could you FOIA this? CNN's reporting that that Omarosa, does she have a last name? Yeah. Is it Mangold? Mangold. Omarosa Mangold said the president-elect's campaign.
I'm going to start using that too. Hey, Mangold. What's up?
Is keeping a list of people who did not support his run to the White House. There's something like 68 million people? A big list. Let me just tell you, Mr. Trump has a long memory, and we're keeping a list. Mangold, the campaign's director of African-American outreach. I wonder if that's a problem, because there's a lot of black people at the top of the list just because those are the first ones that she came across.
Exactly.
Who said, I'm not favoring Donald Trump.
I think America can't even do dignified fascism.
She told this to the Independent Journal Review, an online news outlet started by two former GOP staffers aimed at a center-right audience. That's what we should call this, the Independent Majority Report. Review.
Aimed at what kind of audience?
Aimed at I don't know, center to a left audience.
There we go.
But that's the thing. It's like you hear Independent Journal Review. You're like, oh, is that what university is that associated with? Oh, it's associated with two Republican staffers. Oh, I bet you that's very independent. Mangold made the comment in response to Senator Lindsey Graham's tweet that he supported conservative presidential candidate Evan McMullen. We're all going to die. It appears I was right. I thought I was right, but in the wrong way. So apparently he's on the list. Mangold, who is an ordained minister, she's an ordained minister, responded by suggesting that the South Carolina Republican was an enemy and said, God bless him. That's what happens when you get on the list. Get a blessing from God.
I thought it was ISIS, but it's Omarosa. Oh, my Lord. Tom Collins, anyone?
It's so great our enemies are making themselves clear so that when we get into the White House, we know where we stand.
Psychotic.
I just want to say, reality show contestant added. So there you have it.
Great
maybe
job.
That's what we should do. We should have, like, when we get the when we redo the website, maybe we should have, we should be able to post every day, like a updated enemies list.
Us again. Can I just do take a page from Donald Trump? And I'm thinking specifically of when he was sort of accepting a Ted Cruz olive branch at one point and making clear that he, of course, never was trying to insult Ted Cruz's wife by posting an unflattering, retweeting an unflattering picture of her. And, of course, he wasn't really trying to imply that Ted Cruz's dad was involved in assassinating JFK. All of the comments that I've made about Donald Trump potentially being inappropriate with his daughter, I mean, is a compliment. I mean, Ivanka's great. Please take me off of the enemies list. I mean, I don't think there's anything wrong with having weird, bizarre fixations on your daughter. I mean, I just brought it up. What do I know? All I know is what I hear.
He's off the list. Take him off the list.
Take him off the list. Great job.
Put him on the nice guy. Put him on the good guy list.
Nice guy.
Put him on the good guy list. Send him a tie.
Let's do each day reversal. You and I will go on and off the good guy, bad guy list.
Hey, I listened to the Majority Report. I listened to the Independent Majority Report Review Journal yesterday. It's my favorite show.
It's a great show.
By the way,
Michael's off the list. He's on the good guy list. Sam is on the bad guy list.
And then it's so weird. I listen the next day. All of a sudden, Michael's on the bad list. Sam's on the good guy list. Those guys are crazy.
Being present is exhausting.
By the way, Glenn, I got your letter. I'm too busy, as you said, to take you off the enemies list because I'm too busy being a sociopath.
I think I'm a hands for not having genuine human interactions with people, Glenn.
I want to know how it is that Donald Trump, when he becomes president, day one, better involved getting to the bottom of this whole Ted Cruz JFK assassination thing.
Fair play.
I mean, want seriously. Answers. I want answers, and he is my president. And in the interest of unity, I would like to know.
And there are JFK records that are set to be released under Trump administration, so we should be able to get to the bottom of it.
Can we also FOIA what he rates Angela Merkel?
Got a massive spreadsheet. That's just
massive. 2.2 on a good day.
All right.
Oh, my God. They requested rankings from FOIA? They're on the good guy list.
Let's listen. Like I say, when you shatter norms, they get shattered. And I don't think that we have ever seen in this country protests of this size against a president-elect for being a president-elect. And I count me in as being supportive. There is no reason for people not to come out and peacefully protest and send a message to the country that we're not going to tolerate the vehicle that brought this guy into the presidency. And even if you believe, and I think there's definitely an argument, that part of his appeal was an economic populism, and undoubtedly there was some of that. And the question is, how many voters were really driven by that as opposed to against Hillary Clinton as a person, against a Democrat? And then, motivated by all the PC stuff that the guy from Reason Magazine wrote about, which in my mind is really just sort of the last vestiges of racism and misogyny. And let me just say this, too. If you don't think, like I say, I think it's quite possible that there were tens of thousands of votes out there
because I don't think anybody's making the argument that we're talking about millions of votes. I mean, he underperformed Mitt Romney. And when we talk about these counties in Wisconsin or Ohio or in Michigan or in Pennsylvania, we're not talking millions. We're talking at the most tens of thousands, maybe 100,000 of those type of like hidden white voters or voters who voted for Obama but voted for Trump this time around. Let me tell you what Wayne LaPierre said back in 2015.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Okay? No, because you see these things thrown around. They may be evidence of people responding to a populist message, or they may be responding to Wayne LaPierre, his characterization. There's no telling how far Obama will go to reshape America. And when he's finished, he intends to go with the coronation of Hillary Rodham Clinton. Yeah, I have to tell you, 8 years of one demographically symbolic president is enough. This is what I have been saying in terms of what has motivated white males to perceive Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama as the same. It's not just racism. It's some, and it's not just misogyny. It is emanating from that guy that when I look at the president, I was willing to vote for Barack Obama, maybe, because it's time they have a shot at it. But you mean I got to wait two presidents? They got to have two people in line? No, this is like every other lane. This is the way you merge into traffic, every other car. And really, it should be, you know, maybe three of us, one of them. Three of us, one of them. There's a perception that I'm not going to allow, or I'm not going to vote for someone who doesn't look like me to be president twice in a row. I mean, we gave you that. We gave it to you. 8 years of one demographically symbolic president is enough, is the attitude. So here are these protests nationwide basically saying, you know what, as far as you're having a problem with demographically symbolic presidents, go F yourself.
Upset about Donald Trump's victory are taking to the streets Wednesday night protesting his presidential win. You can see what looks like hundreds of people outside Trump Tower in Chicago. Meantime, in Washington, D.C., crowds are gathering again outside a Trump hotel. And a few protesters got somewhat violent with staff as they tried to push back a barricade. There you see that. Here's a look at Philadelphia, where protesters gathered at Thomas Paine Plaza earlier this evening and began marching down Broad Street. Here's a scene in New York City.
I mean, there were thousands in New York. I saw something from UVA, which I think is I don't know if it was coming off of a college campus, the University of Virginia or what, but they were basically saying F Trump, F Trump. And references to the KKK and racism. So, this was going on all around the country, Boston, Chicago, Portland, Seattle, Washington, like I say, college campuses, Massachusetts and California and Pennsylvania. This is pretty unprecedented. And look, having been in protest during the Bush administration against the war with hundreds of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands, and seeing that it did not have any impact, I have a bit of a jaded perspective on this in terms of its efficacy in making change. But I do think that it is healthy in terms of making the establishment understand that there's a lot of anger out there. And it seems to be resonating a little more.
I was just wondering earlier about the,
when you're talking about the analogy with the lanes. Do you think that Bernie would have had the same problem if he would have gotten into the general? If that would have happened, do you think that he would have had the same problem?
No, he's a white guy. Oh, you mean because of the Jewish?
Because he's Jewish.
I think it might have been a bit.
I mean, it's so rabid on the right that it's invisible to the left. That's how I see it, because it's so crazily like.
I think that, frankly, it is less obvious to your average person. First of all, I don't think anti-Semitism is nearly as widespread as misogyny and
or racism.
Right, no.
A. B. I also think that, like, with those people...
He's a white guy.
He's just a white guy. Well, and I don't even think, like, they would necessarily know he's a Jew.
Could we make don't you think, though...
It would have been made known.
I mean, there would have been ads. But
they would have done... They would have done stuff with that.
I mean, stuff like that would have been really problematic for them. Because, like, you don't have to say Hillary Clinton is a woman.
Right.
But you don't have to say that he is Jewish to have all of the crazy Alex Jones and the alt-right and everyone making it a huge...
They're around anyway.
It would be more like Bush 2000s in South Carolina against McCain kind of stuff, I think. But I think what it would be is that all of the base of support for Trump would either be anti-Semitic or fair, you know, happy to vote for a bigot regardless. Bernie might have gotten some of those voters that actually flipped between Obama and Trump. I don't think it would have been determinative, and then, you know, maybe he would have excited the base more.
I mean, listen, from throughout the primary, I said that I thought Bernie would be a stronger candidate against Trump, just sort of like subjectively speaking, and we pointed out all the time the polls had him up there. Now, he was untested and blah blah blah, but I mean. You know, the theory that somehow Hillary Clinton was going to be inoculated from being attacked was obviously not accurate. Yes, they would have slammed him from wherever it was, May or June, into the general for being a socialist. But I just don't think that would have resonated in the same way. I definitely think that he would have won. Counterfactuals are difficult because, remember, Bloomberg was threatening to run at that time. Who knows if he would have done that or not? But if Bloomberg had jumped in, it seems to me that he could have also helped Donald Trump win. Right? Maybe Bloomberg takes those suburban Republican voters.
Big league.
But maybe he also takes a bunch of, like, the corporate Democrats and... then leaves Trump with 35%. I don't know. Bernie with 30.
Right.
I mean,
that's
you don't know. Also, Bloomberg could have realized that in this scenario and said, like, I'm not going to run because I'm, you know, better Bernie than Trump. I mean, you just don't know is my point. But certainly, and frankly, I also think that Clinton could have won with some very minor campaign adjustments, like visit Wisconsin, listen to the people who are telling you that you got to go out there. Now,
here's a thought.
Say something about the economy. Talk about how, I mean, I don't want to harp on
you
this,
have
but
that
I kept
wrong.
Saying you've got to run against Donald Trump as a Republican, too, because you've got to convince people that there's a reason to vote for you as a Democrat.
And because I agree that it's totally, absolutely ludicrous, but even just, not on the sort of left intramural debate we do, I know people who would be more, I don't know what you call them, quote unquote, in the center or undecided or whatever. And they really genuinely thought that just by the horrible person metric, there was no difference. And they were just trying to determine... You know,
which policy set was going
to
be better?
Literally that. Yeah. From that completely ridiculous premise, that's what they were trying to do.
That metaphor about getting into a mud fight with a pig.
They thought it was a wash. They did.
So, like we've been talking about, there's a lot of people whose plans have changed dramatically with the win of Donald Trump. And one of those people is this guy, Tom Cotton, who many people were saying was going to be almost like arguably the titular front runner in 2020. You know, maybe a guy with a, you know, Paul Ryan would be up there, but Tom Cotton was going to bring up the insane wing, but also smart, insane wing. And he still is both insane and this Harvard grad is also pretty smart. And here he is talking about, you know, getting a little nitpicky about all the things that are supposedly torture. This guy, look, here's one of the greatest dangers that Donald Trump represents to this country, it seems to me, is that as Osama bin Laden knew, if he attacks with a when there is a the more militaristic party is in charge, he will hopefully get an overreaction. In many respects, Donald Trump is the president today because of Osama bin Laden's actions. Or I should say, Osama bin Laden, when he was sort of sitting in that cave, supposedly, and saying to his friends, look, this is what's going to happen. We're going to attack here. And for decades, it's going to resonate out. This is what's going to take down America. I'm guessing within 16 years, they're going to be so effed up, they'll vote for Donald Trump. And everybody in the cave laughs, and he's like, I'm serious. And everybody's like, no. And he's like, but
I hate them, the great Satan, but do you really think the American people are stupid enough to actually elect that guy president? I mean, don't get me wrong. It's a den of infidels. But are they really that stupid?
Listen, George Bush would have been a one-termer without, he was very weak in that first year in terms of like public support. He would have been a one-termer without it. And he was a one-termer. You do not get the conservative movement you have today. Here is Tom Cotton, and maybe this is the way he's applying for a job with the defense secretary. I don't know.
Final thing on the alleged torture issue, waterboarding. Your colleague John McCain, who himself was tortured as a POW during the Vietnam War, he says waterboarding is a violation of the Geneva Convention's international law right now, and he strongly opposes it.
Well, I understand Senator McCain's position, of course, but on this one, I disagree. Now, as a matter of federal law might have to change if the president was to take this policy and the president-elect would have to come to Congress. But ultimately, I would say that anything that American troops volunteer for, that radio DJs volunteer for, is not torture. And if it has to be done to save American lives, that's a tough call.
Because if you're violating the Geneva Conventions, you could be charged with war crimes.
Well, the American... America gets charged with a lot that is scandalous in my eyes by countries like Iran and Syria and other gross human rights abusers. America does not torture. We never have and we never will.
Well, you know how you ensure that America never does torture? You change the law as to what is torture, which he's proposing here, would have to happen. And you ignore the Geneva Conventions, which you've signed, which say that it's torture. That's how you never torture. It's like that old joke, you know, Michael, what time is it? And you say, I don't know, but I know it's not 5 p.m. And I say, why? And you say, because I'm supposed to be home at 5 p.m.
That's a real knee slapper.
That's not a very good bon mot. So there's Tom Cotton basically saying, advocating, let's change the law so that waterboarding is not torture, because I don't consider it torture because I've seen guys attempt to do it. And I think all of them basically who did that said like, yeah, no, that's torture.
Insert incest redefinition, Trump and Ivanka joke here. Where does that sound from again?
That is from Fistful of Dollars. Oh, well, and I mean, it's really The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. Let's go to the phones. People on hold for a while. Calling from a 206 area code. Who's this?
Hi, my name is Jarrett, and I'm from Seattle.
What's on your mind, Jarrett?
I guess I have a little different set of grimacing news other than, you know, the obvious Trump presidency. But, you know, one of the problems that Democrats have had is they don't really have, like, a bench to draw from for, you know, any of these really important races. Like, there's a small bench, I guess, for the presidency.
Yeah.
But then for, like, other races, like, they don't really have, like, a huge list of people to draw from for Senate or even Congress, and they're losing state houses. And I think I looked at a list really briefly. There are, like, 13 states in 2018 that Republicans could easily target for the Senate. And yep. if they get 8 of them, then they have a supermajority.
Yep.
So I guess I don't – what's, like – I mean, and that's just for Democrats as a whole, nonetheless progressives. So I don't know. I guess if I'm going to ask a question, what do you sort of see that the Democrats really need to do to just play on this massive defensive wall that they sort of have to do now? Because are the Republicans at, like, the most powerful they've ever been right now?
Yep. Let me let you go. I'll answer the question. I appreciate it. It's a good question. I don't know that I have a great answer for you. I think part of the reason why McConnell won't necessarily do the filibuster right now for legislation is, even though Scott Walker apparently called for it, did he call for it with that Charlie Sykes interview? Yeah, I don't want to play that. It's too long. Scott Walker's doing that just because, you know, he's on the outside. And so what you do when you're on the outside is you force them to do this stuff on the inside. And they have a plan already to get rid of Obamacare through reconciliation. They are then going to push another budget later in the year through reconciliation. I think Mitch McConnell will not get rid of the filibuster when it comes to legislation. I think he might in terms of the Supreme Court. Before 2018, because he wants the Democrats to obstruct. And he wants to blame the Democrats for not being able to deliver on all the things they've talked about delivering. So they get rid of Obamacare, and it won't go into effect until after the midterms. And then the idea is that he thinks that they can get a supermajority or get close enough to it, pull a couple of Democrats over. The question is, you know, what can Democrats do to, if not take back the Senate, at least to not get destroyed in 2018? And, you know, Maggie Hassan winning helps. Winning that in New Hampshire, having that New Hampshire Senate seat. I think the answer is you have to cleave Trump from the congressional Republicans. And that means that we're going to see some deals that we don't like, that the Democrats are going to try and pursue. So, because they can't stop a lot of this stuff anyways. So you may see a deal like, you know, this tax repatriation thing may now happen, or some type of infrastructure spending deal that maybe Paul Ryan doesn't like. That might get Paul Ryan in trouble with his Freedom Caucus people. I don't know what else to do. I think that, you know, you can focus on the presidency and one hand call Trump illegitimate, on the other hand, you know, be willing to do some deals with him. I just don't know how you you get that interfighting. And then I think, like, the only thing you can talk about is, like, maybe I think you've just got to push harder for, like, all of these proposals that we've talked about in terms of expansion of Social Security and all of this that are not going to happen. You need to nationalize them. The Democrats need to have a populist message and ask the Republicans, why aren't you doing this? And then when they jam down our throats this tax repatriation, that type of stuff. So I wish I had a better answer for you, but I'm not sure exactly. Nathan Flower, serious question. How do we face our families this holiday season? You know, traditionally we have Janine on the day before Thanksgiving to deal with this. We're going to try and get her in, but I don't know. D. Chetson, let's preview the 2018 races. Democrats have two potential pickups, Arizona with Jeff Flake and Nevada with Heller. They probably will not win Flake. They may win against Heller. All others are incumbent Democrats up for re-election. Democrats up for re-election will probably lose West Virginia, Manchin, who may flip Republican himself. He might, but I don't see, like, where he'd get much for doing that. At this point, you know, what do they need him for? Who cares about vote 53?
What do we need you for?
North Dakota, Heidi Heitkamp. Montana, John Tester. Democrats may very well lose Indiana and Missouri. They may also lose Florida, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. That's a near certain pickup of three of the Republicans and a probable pickup of another three or four. And if things really go the Republicans' way, it's not bizarre to think Republicans may get a filibuster-proof Senate. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's what we've just been talking about. Andy Anderson. Michael's right, as demonstrated by Rudy Giuliani, Glenn Beck, and Tom Cotton clips. There are just going to be too many moments of nausea every day to narrow down to one. Also, as a Mormon, still partially active in faith, but ready to leave for good after this election. I got to tell you, Glenn Beck is the quintessential sociopathic middle-aged Mormon male. His cadence is so Mormon, it's embarrassing. MR member, we all knew a Clinton loss was possible when she took Dem base for granted, focused on chasing Republican voters. At least Obama waited till he won before he threw us overboard. Indeed, Chelsea from Chicago. Hey, Sam, just wanted to write in to encourage all your listeners with uteruses to choose to use contraception of any kind to explore getting an IUD as soon as possible. They're free under the Affordable Care Act and can last anywhere from 3 to 12 years, depending on which type you choose, which you can carry us through much of the incoming administration, wherein we can expect soaring costs, if not outright bans. Good point. Yeah, my sister was asking, like, what can, you know, she's like, you got to talk about, like, what people like me can do. And, you know, that's going to be something, like, you know, off the top of my head, I don't have a list.
I think it will come about.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the things we're
going to
be trying to do.
We are going to do things. I mean, you could see even with the protests, and I don't think that that's going away. Not that it's sufficient, but people are
going to
work.
But supporting organizations that are going to be first on the line of attacks, like Planned Parenthood is one of them.
And I think it depends. Like, I had a friend of mine call me the other day who's now he's an assistant attorney general in Massachusetts. And I actually, apparently the current attorney general, she's very good. And she kind of made the rounds and basically said, like, you know, to the extent we have any power in this office in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, we're going to fight every single thing, you know, to the extent we can, which obviously is a major uphill battle, but it's not as if nothing is happening. It's not as if there isn't openings.
Demon, it was mentioned. Yeah, I mean, that's why, like, if you're in a blue state or a purple state, I mean, state elections are going to become really, really, really crucial.
Need to get out.
It was mentioned in that interview that the Clinton campaign learned only on that the media only covered them when they talked about the Clinton camp on the Trump campaign. Do you think it itself is a sign in order to get media coverage on the issues, Democrats need to hold more radical positions that will stir up discussions? Like, if she had just said, she wants to fix Obamacare, they won't cover it as much as a full single-payer proposal. I mean, I think there's something to be said about that. I mean, I really do. You know, Donald Trump has showed, at least in the context of the media, the way you get coverage is by being, you know, the villain. Or, you know, we're in this sort of social media world where, you know, you cut through it by having an extreme position. So, for instance, like, you know, well, look, I'm not going to get into that, but that sometimes, you know, our nuance sometimes hurts us, I think, in our social media game. Also, name for nausea
it
segment.
Undermines
this
our
is your
core
life
brand
now.
Proposition.
I love Sarah Palin. Went to a Trump celebration party with a friend. Some people heard I didn't vote for Trump, but they were actually really nice. Actually, I heard it as part of his outreach to Hillary voters. He's sending us all to a really special camp, all expenses paid. Ab ki bar Trump. Sarcasm. Any idea where Alex Jones' narrative goes from here? No, we should check in on that. Brain freeze. I saw this posted somewhere. It's a really depressing thought. America's first black president will now have to hand over the place to the man endorsed by the KKK. Let that sink in.
Alex Jones had Gavin McGinnis on, and they have like a 12-minute clip where they're basically, Gavin is trying to convince Alex, like, just take this time to celebrate, man.
Nick the Liberal. New Paul Harvey spot from Mike to do on Majority Report. Welcome, patriots, to Trump's America. Here's the liberal instant... of sunshiny positive affirmation. Seems the Bernie bros are banding together in New Jersey, hoping their list of 5,000 bros can take over the local DNC seat. But to what end, you say? Beware, bosses. I can't follow this. Blue. I can get behind Keith Ellison for DNC chair, but I also got the idea in my head that Van Jones would be really good. His recent videos have stressed the need for Dems to focus on the economically marginalized. I mean, I prefer Keith Ellison. I like, there's been times I've really appreciated Van Jones, what he's saying rhetorically. He had an organization that really didn't do much at one point after he got out of the administration. So I don't know. And here's the thing. What I didn't get into it with Adam. If Keith Ellison becomes the DNC chair, he has all of a sudden a huge relative to what he has now. I mean, if you're a congressman, this is going to seem, this is so banal, but it makes so much sense. If you're a congressman from Minnesota who is not a corporate Democrat, so you're not raising a ton of money, okay? The amount of money that you get to run your office from the U.S. government is minimal. You have one or two staffers there. And there's only so much you can do. But if you're running the DNC, your staff gives you the ability to build a movement. I mean, I think to a certain extent, like, that's part of the reason why an Elizabeth Warren would be interested in being vice president. It's just staff all of a sudden, like, you can, like, I want to pursue this. You too. You know, boom. I mean, that's like, you know, when you look at, like, you know, I look at the staffs and the budgets of places like Democracy Now! Or, like, NPR shows. And they would have, you know, triple the staff, quadruple the staff that we have to do this. And then if they get more staff, they have someone like, I'm doing, you know, 3 to 6 to 9 month, 12 month strategic planning on where to take the show. As opposed to I'm walking somebody through how they get their feed on their iPod. I mean, it's that banal. And, you know, for a guy like Keith Ellison to have an expansive staff, you know, Van Jones can go out and he can raise money and build an organization. Keith Ellison can't do that in the same way because he's a congressman. And he's, I think it would be good. It would give the progressive caucus in Congress more power, which I think is important. Communist dog, Donald Trump, I hope he fails. Indeed. Big Mama. Sam, do you think we'll see a flat tax under Trump? I don't know. Maybe. I think we're going to see tax cuts for the wealthy. I don't know what else beyond that. Joseph Ballin. Please, Sam, try and read all of this. You have to start fighting back right now. Here's the following stuff we need to do. Push for abolishing the Electoral College. That's a state-by-state thing. The way that that happens, where you do national popular vote, you need to get enough states that equal 270 electoral votes so that they basically say, okay, whoever wins the popular vote amongst all of us, I mean, you know, aggregated, we will automatically allot those votes to that person, the electoral votes. So that's a statewide thing. But yes, filibuster any Supreme Court nominee. I woke up on November 9th. The first thing I did was call my Democratic senator. Yes, I agree. That should be full on obstruction there. They've set the marker down, and I think the Democrats need to do that. They must obstruct every single bill. I mean, that is the debate, right? I mean, do you obstruct every bill? Maybe. And we need to create self-sustaining communities. Lawn Chair Media, Texas went for Trump by 9 points. It was 16 points for Romney. The first person to mention to me the trend toward Democrats was a staffer I knew for John Cornyn in 08. I think we can make substantial gains in Texas by 2020. Yep. Cecil, two words for President Obama. Pardon Melania. Carl Sagan. So how should we position ourselves toward our congresspeople and senators? Should we write them a letter saying they must adopt the Bernie fundraising model? Should we tell them to make a public statement? I just write them and say, fight. Obstruct. Must stop the Trump agenda. Intersectional feudalist. Can you please have Connor Kilpatrick from Jacobin on to talk about the white working class? Also, can we focus on purging the party of leadership from on down from neoliberals? We're going to have a couple of folks from there who had written this piece about engage in politics. This includes discrediting pundits, wants like Klein, Chait, Iglesias. We need more universal policy platforms, no more overly complex wonkery. I mean,
I agree with that.
I mean, I think. Tough time to be in the wonkery business right now. And I got to tell you, like, you know, like.
I have a quibble about that. Oh, well, I'm going to the gulag. Okay.
I mean, I'm on a list with people who are writing these most heartbreaking things, who are like, you know, 10 years older than me. And like they have been working relentlessly on. Professionally, they're that on how to make certain fixes to certain things, and all that work is now irrelevant. It's irrelevant now. There is going to be no fix to Obamacare, and I think there's an awareness now that what has been done in the past is like, well, maybe we can tweak the edges of Ryan Care and make it better. And no, you can't, because all that's going to happen is you're going to get sucked in. You're going to own something that and they're going to give you ownership of the part that people don't like. They cut Medicare. That's how they won in 2010, right? They cut Medicare, the Democrats.
And it was the same thing. People
that
wrote,
was a gift to the Republicans.
And they wrote credulous articles like, oh, I can't believe the Republicans are campaigning on this when they made it happen. Like as if they're still actually right. Believed in 2014 that this was a good faith opponent.
I mean, on one hand, this is a terrifying era aside from Trump, even if it was a generic Republican, because they are so rabid. And on the other hand, there's also a little bit less naivete on the left, I think. A little bit. Calling from a 228 area code. Who's this?
Hello?
Hello. What's your name?
Oh, this is Jesse from Santa Rosa. I apologize. I was just at the fridge.
No apology necessary, Jesse. What did you get?
Yeah. Been a rough week, but I just wanted to cover a few things. If you have the time, specifically Flint, Michigan,
yep.
I think you address a really good point here. And I want to look at this in two ways, if you can, just briefly. One, in the controversy aspect, you got a governor there who is so easy to really, really villainize and put somebody on a stump, i.e. a presidential candidate, and tie him directly to Trump.
Yep.
Poison water. Poison water, poison water. I guarantee you that would have brought 13,000 voters out.
yeah.
and given her Michigan.
Yeah.
That's not even a doubt. And the second point I want to make, which I haven't heard a lot of people say, that I'm really curious about, is you had a team in 08 and 12 that won, that knew what they were doing. Now, you can say anything you want about Obama in office, and yes, there are things that we can agree and disagree with floor-wise, obviously. But you cannot argue with his team, who basically highlighted who to go after, how to go after them, and where. Why wasn't that team utilized 150%? Seriously.
I think that's a great question. I don't have an answer beyond this one, which I don't know is accurate per se. Okay? I've got two sides of this coin. One is a lot of the people went on to go into, private practice or consulting. I don't know. Maybe they moved on from politics, a lot of those people. I don't know. But I also think that one of the things about, the Clinton organization is there's like years and years of legacy. And, I think people broadly thought that their team was strong. And I think, the data team may have been similar, but I guess the idea is that, from a political messaging standpoint, I saw James Carville on TV then, and I was like, the economy's stupid. Like, can you really get through without mentioning any of that? And for me, the way to mention the economy is to talk about this guy's proposals. These are our proposals. Mm-hmm. That was the fundamental flaw in the campaign, right? Is that they only campaigned on how horrible Donald Trump was. And that was a mistake. Appreciate the call.
Well, thanks very much, Sam. Okay. You have a great day and keep your chin up, bud. We'll be all right.
Thanks.
We really will.
You too.
Keep your chin up, man.
I think the DNC basically just learned the cheapest lesson they could, and let's just recreate the data thing and imagine that that's why Obama got elected instead of the change stuff.
Well, yeah, I don't know if it was just the DNC. It was probably, I think that's true. That's also where you can spend money on, right? Calling from a 509 area code. Who's this?
Hey, Sam.
Yep.
This is Ronald Reagan.
Ronald Reagan. How are you? What's on your mind today?
Good.
Ronald Reagan.
I've done you a favor.
Well, I appreciate that.
And compiled an exhaustive list of all the things that we can blame for the election.
Okay, thank you.
So I'm just gonna go through it. Number one is racism. Number two is Chris Hayes.
Right.
Number three is more broadly the media.
Mm-hmm.
And number four is you and Michael going soft on Hillary and getting away from doing real journalism.
Thank you.
And rounding out my top five is misogyny. So.
Okay.
You're welcome. You can just cut this and put it on YouTube and, for your listeners, for their benefit.
Right.
I'm so sorry that I didn't spend the last several weeks just constantly pumping out random WikiLeaks stories about the fact that Hillary and Bernie campaigned against each other. I apologize.
Yeah. Well, apology accepted. I do have one legit criticism of Obama. I know politics are hard, but sometimes it seems like it is actually not. Like, Obama is really funny and good on talk shows. He went on Fallon in June, which is actually kind of a unique skill for a politician to be able to go on one of these shows, which are broadly popular, and kill and do really, really well. And he basically used that opportunity to tell some Trump jokes and to try and push the TPP.
Right.
Which it seems to me like, broadly speaking, for him to make that his last year's work, basically, instead of going out, he could have said, look, Obamacare, I'm proud of it, but these are the fixes that we need. We've got proposed legislation. And I think they just were not ready for
the announcement that the premiums are going up so high, and as somebody who's has insurance and has needed it this year, I mean, it hasn't done me anything. And to know that next year I'm going to be paying even more, I mean, I know that's not the fault of Obamacare, but for most people, they could have used
I think
the
you're absolutely right.
Going
and
out.
I think you're absolutely right. And I hadn't put that second part together in my head, but I think people underestimate the implications of Obama being so fervent on the TPP, because not only the thing is that not only was it bad to have the Democrats and, you know, to have Obama push the TPP because it made people think that Hillary was going to push the TPP once she got into office, but it also curbed her ability to come out and criticize it. I mean, because if you see those WikiLeaks things, if you see the WikiLeaks things, they had already decided a while back to abandon the TPP. And she just could not be as fervent about it because they didn't want her to be bumping up against Obama. And I agree with you. And then he should have come out. They should have been much more oriented to, like, here's the things that we're here's the baton that we're passing. Rather than just saying, here's the baton, we're passing a baton, like actually put some meat on those bones. But that also would have required Clinton to talk about policy as well, which they didn't want to do in the general. So there's, you know, you may have to add more things to your list.
Well, no, I mean, I'm glad you said you agreed. I think maybe you meant just the last point about Obama, but I'm going to assume you also meant the first five things.
No, I meant the first five things too. The only thing I would add to that, maybe if you hadn't had a child and you called in with a little more regularity.
Yeah.
I mean, who knows?
You know why I had a child. It's your fault.
I know. There you go.
Your fault. Hey, listen, one last thing. I'm an immigration lawyer.
I've heard.
And people are in full-on freak-out mode. I think it's important. We're going to start having weekly letter writing meetings for our local congressman who says he supports immigration reform. He blames Congress's lack of action on Obama, which is total crap. But our position is basically going to be, you got the president you wanted. You know, what are you going to do to protect these people? And it's super important that we activate communities and that we push people, because especially the immigrant community, the gut response is to hide and to, you know, because they're so vulnerable, and we have to provide spaces for them, safe spaces where they can be activists, where they can learn, okay, this is my congressman's phone number. I'm going to save it in my phone. I'm going to call him every day on my lunch break. There's little things that people can do, and your listeners are educated, they're involved, and they're creative. So there's things that people can be doing in their community to activate people, to provide safe spaces, and hopefully everyone does that. And I want to say,
well, what
I
are
love
those
you.
Things?
I love
what
the
are those
crew.
Things?
And well, I, like I said, I mean, I think that it's time to, at least with immigration, I mean, people are freaking out because of the amount of harm that Trump.
Yeah, no, but you said there are things that people can do.
One.
What can our listeners do? What can they do, like literally, specifically, practically?
There are organizations, immigrant rights organizations, and in the Northwest is an organization called the Northwest Immigrant Rights Project. They do a lot of litigation on detention and other important issues, and they need volunteers. If you have a legal education, there's a huge need in the immigration field. You know, consider educating yourself and taking on a case or two. There are immigration lawyers and organizations in your community, I'm sure, who are trying to organize. And a lot of times it comes down to, we need a space where we can meet. And if you know, maybe you're a person who has a church gym that you can volunteer. That's complicated for tax
reasons.
Listen,
but maybe do me a favor.
Anyways,
send me an email with some of this stuff, and we'll talk about it, and we'll get it out there.
All right. Later, man.
Appreciate it. Bye.
Bye.
Calling from a 917 area code. Who's this?
Hello?
What's your name?
Hi, is this Sam?
Yeah.
Hey, this is Kristen calling from Brooklyn. I'm a long-term listener. I didn't realize that you'd gotten to me already because of the delay. So I was just calling to talk about the election, obviously, and I think, you know, other folks have said, you know, what I think is true, that there was a, you know, a real lack of mobilizing, you know, the Obama coalition. And I also think that, you know, Hillary didn't give, you know, young people a lot to rally around. I mean, you know, I have cousins who are young women who live in upstate New York who voted for Trump. They're not religious. They're not, you know, they're not the kind of people you would expect to fall into that category, and yet they did. And they're not people who are racist or anti-gay. I just think that in the absence of a positive message that showed them a future for themselves, they went with the, you know, the authoritarian. I don't know exactly what drew them to him, but yeah. I think that, you know, I think we also shouldn't underestimate how much that, you know, 25 years of the media telling people to hate Hillary impacted that.
Yeah.
And I just don't think we realize that.
Yeah, I think you're right.
You know?
I mean, so there's some things that were unique to Clinton, and there were some things, like, you know, you can't say to another candidate, don't have 25 years of the media or 30 years of the media basically saying that you're, you know, a calculating evil person. I mean, that's the thing. There's so many elements to this that had to sort of coalesce. But so from my perspective, the most helpful ones, it seems to me, are the ones that, like, were not unique to Clinton, that she had control over as a candidate and could have done differently. And that's what, you know, trying to focus on some level going forward.
Yeah, I mean, I've been thinking about that, and I've also been thinking about, I was glad to hear about the push for Keith Ellison, because I do think that, and I've been reading Jane McAlevey's book, and, you know, I really do think that it's that person-to-person organizing that we really have to do, and I think it goes beyond labor. I mean, I don't know how much you guys are aware of this, but, you know, 6 months ago, I live in New York, I live in Park Slope, 6 months ago, oh, Michael, you can visit me anytime. I'm the one that posted on your wall earlier. We're Facebook friends, saying that, you know, I really appreciated you guys the last couple of days.
Oh, thank you.
And sorry, you're sick of saying I had to go home. But
you got to be very careful about inviting Michael over, because he may never leave.
He may not leave. But, you know, but here in New York State, 6 months ago, we had the Empire State Pride agenda, which was the, you know, the state's largest LGBT rights organization, close up shop. You know, there is still tons of work to be done for trans people, tons of work to be done, you know,
it's going to be
around employment.
The backlash, the assault is happening now.
And yes.
Right. And this organization's gone.
Yeah.
And, like, we learned nothing from abortion rights.
No, well, it's all because it's a class thing. It's a class thing.
Michael
too.
Signorelli was, I mean, he wrote a book specifically about this. I think it was Michael, right?
So,
Michael
Signorelli.
It's not over yet, or something.
Not over
like
yet. And also, I remember having a conversation a couple years with a guy who was an LGBT activist, and actually, like, much more in, like, the Bloomberg Hillary Clinton end of the spectrum politically. But even he was like, you know, we're having all of these major victories, but I notice on a grassroots level that funding for, like, you know, homeless issues for LGBT youth, the funding is draining up and people are not focusing on that at all.
Absolutely. I mean, and this is the mentality of folks like Andrew Sullivan, who, you know, Andrew Sullivan said in the 90s, he was like, we win marriage equality, we win employment authorization, we reverse our national intel, and then we have a party and shut down the movement. And, you know, obviously we're much more hip about intersectionality now, but, like, that strain of thinking that you win some sort of victory politically and it's written in concrete is just completely at odds with how politics actually works.
Let me quote again from that Eric Foner interview that Mike Konzel wrote about. The Foner, of course, a big Civil War reconstruction historian, perhaps the most famous. Rights can be won and rights can be taken away. Achievements are always vulnerable. Yep. And I think on the left we have a very this is a problem, you know, broadly speaking with the left. It seems to me it's like, oh, we got Barack Obama elected. Let's all go to sleep now. And that happens, it seems to me, over and over again. And, all right.
We also believe in progress too much. I don't mean in terms of normatively, of course, we believe in progress, but we believe in some like almost like theological process of like inevitabilities and evolution. And that's like you're saying, it's not how it works in politics.
Right.
Appreciate the call.
There is that MLK quote, which I think is so wonderful about the arc of history bending toward justice. And I hope that that's the case, but it's not going to happen on its own. It's not fated. So, I really appreciate you guys. I constantly share your podcast. I think you guys are doing great stuff. And I have no critiques, and I don't think that you should be more or less like Chris Hayes. I think you should just be awesome.
Thank you. I appreciate it, guys. I wonder how freaked out Hayes would be. I should tell him that like 80% of the podcast is just talking about him.
I'm freaked out by it, so I could only imagine what his response would be.
It comes up like constantly now. It's like worse than like one back, like. He's like my new Mark Maron.
God.
Calling from a 515 area code. Who's this? Where are you calling from?
Oh, this is Sanjeeva from Ames, Iowa.
Hey,
a little bit disappointed about the election, but I was looking at Our Revolution site, and about 50% of the candidates who weren't in the Midwest or a rural area survived.
Yeah.
And also, I was talking with a good friend from Kansas. The Kansas was Democratic Party actually gained seats when all the other Midwestern states lost. What happened was, like, in 2014, after Sam Brownback kicked the Democrats' asses in Kansas, they engaged in, like, a rural engagement program. So they went to small towns. Went on a listening tour, figured out some basic bread and butter issues like fixing the roads or some grain elevators, and then they won their trust, and they won a record number of seats since 1976. So I've learned from a friend of my dad's who's an ardent Democrat. I call him like a Archie Bunker Democrat. He has very his racial politics and political correctness is just not good. But he was saying, like, Tim Kaine and Debbie Wasserman Schultz have basically destroyed the rural outreach mechanism in the Midwest. So, and we need to rebuild that if we want to win the Midwest in the long term.
I think you're right. And that also has to do with agricultural policies. Obama
I was looking at Clinton's. I looked at Clinton's agricultural policies. Those were really good, but she didn't spend much time honing her message on those issues.
Well, she didn't spend much time delivering it to people. She didn't spend much time.
Yeah, she ran a PC outrage campaign in Iowa, and she got destroyed by it. So,
really speaking to those farmers.
Jackson did.
Yeah.
Well, Jesse Jackson, you know what? Go back and listen to the interview that I did with Bill Fletcher back last spring, and he explained, and that was, my God, those were the days of the primary, but he was explaining how, you know, Jesse Jackson in that context of that conversation was more effective than Bernie Sanders. But that was the point, that he was able to have some universal messaging. And that is where the economic stuff is unavoidable, because that's how you can build those coalitions.
All right. I got to jump. I appreciate the call.
Thanks.
Good call.
Yep.
All right. We have time for one more call, and then I'm going to take some IMs, and then we're going to wrap it up for today. Tomorrow we'll have another day. I mean, we're doing extended.
We're going to have another day tomorrow? Yes.
We're going to have another day? What? What? Friday's going to happen.
You said tomorrow we're going to have another day. I'm just saying, great.
Somebody suggested the daily Trump dump as the your moment of nausea.
No, yuck.
I like that.
That could be good.
I vote for that.
Trump dump.
Yeah, but you guys all think poop jokes are so funny. And
I you know,
I'm not the only one. I got news for you.
I know you're not the only one.
Saul thinks they're hilarious.
I have never been. I'm not that into poop
dump
jokes.
Doesn't
That's
only
wrong,
mean
actually.
Poop though. I feel it works on multiple levels.
I know, but it was
I like poop jokes that
remind,
work on multiple levels.
Yeah, it will just always remind me. It's just I hate poop jokes.
Well, it's
I just hate them.
It just it rhymes.
Yeah, Sam loves them.
I no, love Sam them. Is by far the most scatological of anyone in this office.
Saul,
no doubt.
Wait, Saul's. What is the joke that he's been like constantly telling? I mean, it's not that funny.
that one,
but it's like
the one where he just goes.
It's like he'll do knock knock. Who's there? Poop.
See, it. But that's actually pretty good. That's
and,
good material.
I'm gonna write for the White House Correspondents' Dinner, kid.
There you go. Exactly.
Hey, who's there? Knock knock.
What was he? Oh gosh, now I can't even remember what it is. I haven't slept much over the past couple of days. I don't know if anybody's picked up on that. All right, one more call. Right, I said that already. Eight, call him from an. I guess it's gonna show up here. Oh, I know you're there.
Hello.
832 area code.
I'm there.
Who's this?
Yeah, this is Robert from Florida.
Hi, Robert. What's on your
kinda
mind?
Kind of depressed.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So I just got a comment and a question, and the comment was, I'm kind of stuck in the second stage, and I think I'm gonna stay there.
The second stage, and, what? First, it's what is it? Sadness, denial. Where is that? I don't know.
Denial, and then anger.
Anger. Oh yeah.
So I think I'm going to stay in anger.
We're going to be in anger for a
while.
We
all
got to
keep anger.
I've also made a decision that I've never going to say his name, and I agree with you. Never president.
Right.
So that means to talk to people, I got to come up with different names for them. So I've been tossing around a few. I was thinking about the pervert, but that's kind of mild. And Pepe right. the Frog, but a lot of people don't kind of get that. So then I was thinking, the OSP, because that's short.
OSP.
Which is, and then they'll have to ask me what that means, and that's it's the orange sexual predator.
Mm. You know what I like?
And then there's the pussy grabber. Well, the pussy grabber is sort of where
that's now that
awkward.
He'll like that
that's
one. Yeah, yeah, I am.
You know what I like? President Plugs.
President Plug, that's good.
Right.
Oh, that's good. Actually, I was thinking about for your daily dump, it could be the daily pussy grabber.
Daily, I feel like that wouldn't have the same shareability on Facebook.
but now, for something, a couple of things. I keep hearing about this, well, it was because of economic anxiety excuse. And I always go back towards, blacks and black people, Hispanic people, they got a lot of economic anxiety.
Their economic anxiety doesn't work. It doesn't count for the same.
They didn't support the OSP. The white people did. So,
I mean, that's a very good point. I mean, I think the perception is by those voters. I mean, to be fair, I agree with you. And I think there's a tendency to sort of feel like, wait. Why is it just the white working class is the only working class that's relevant in this conversation? The belief is, I think, with these white working class voters, or I should say the argument is that the belief is amongst those voters that they perceive the Democrats, and particularly Clinton, as responding more to the concerns of Latinos and African Americans more than they do white people. And there is, look, this again is, in my estimation, I don't think these concepts are mutually exclusive, but I think, like, if you've grown up in an environment where every time somebody talks about somebody's problems, every time somebody talks about a protagonist in whatever situation, whether it's like in the shampoo commercial or on the sitcom or the drama or, what's going on in town. And every time that person is a white male, And then all of a sudden you move into an era where, like, no, the protagonist in this situation is she's a black woman. No, the protagonist is a Latino. Then I think there's like this sort of cultural grievance, like I've lost something and nobody's paying attention to me anymore. And I, you know, well, that's true. That's, you're right. You're experiencing that, but that's what, you know, it sucks.
That's white nationalism.
Yeah. I mean, it's certainly a form of it. It's certainly not recognizing that, you know, that's a privilege that you had for a long time and now you just don't have it anymore. I mean, you know, we had to explain this to my daughter. You were an only child for a while. Now, guess what? Gotta share your room. It sucks.
We need to make the Cedar household great again.
It does suck. It does suck. You have 50% of the room you used to have.
I will build a wall around my...
That's actually what we did. We built a wall, a three-quarter wall. But, yeah, it's a problem. Appreciate the phone call. Thanks.
My friend, good friend of mine, they're a couple years older, and they have like a 2.5-year-old and a 3-year-old, and the 3-year-old was like, can Joya go back inside the womb?
Yep. Mila, when she was age 6, was like, I think we should just give him away. Well, no, she was 6. She was like 7.5, 8. I mean, she, you know, for a long time, she was an only child.
Like, guys, I'm spitballing a concept here. The giveaway option.
All right. We're going to do 5 IMs. Benjamin, we're all paying the price for underestimating the opposition and their candidate. The DNC, the media, Hillary's campaign, third-party voters, those who sat out, even some Republicans. A lot of work ahead, indeed. And us, I think, too.
Yep.
Masshole. Random rush.
No.
Not today, thanks. Saha. Oh, my God, I feel so much better. Keep talking, Sam. I hope these Bernie folks get out there marching, or this country will manifest their dangerous parallel universe. I'm not sure I follow. I don't get it. Angelo Scantino, dear Sam, sayonara. I'll always be a listener, but I'm moving to Korea. I'll still vote from abroad, but my Tea Party mother and everyone else that voted for Orange Hitler can rot. We'll get our comeuppance, and once we do, no mercy to these deplorables. Safe travels. Smurf, what's the likelihood that gay marriage rights will be repealed? Libertarian saying Edward Snowden, silent post-election results. I am quite sure that we're going to see Roe v. Wade repealed. And abortion is going to be a function of states. And that we will have only about 10, 12 states that abortion will be legal. I'm thinking like 10, 15 years out. Obergefell, I think that is tougher. I just feel like culturally, it's moved on. It doesn't have the salience for Republicans. I mean, that, you know, abortion still has. So I think that's less likely to be overturned. I do think that's less likely to be overturned. But we'll see. Attorney Andrew. Trump is floating Jamie Dimon for Treasury Secretary. Oh my God! Can you effing believe that?
Oh, and it's really
because the banks are so horrible.
Yeah, and by the way, his whole economic transition team is totally committed to dismantling.
That's what this guy said.
Dodd-Frank, and mysteriously, all of these mentions that sometimes devil's advocate people would say, you know, of like who's really worse. I haven't heard any Glass-Steagall restoration mentions at all.
Attorney Andrew, I can't read this whole thing, but he says any of these diagnoses election must account for these things. Hillary got 7 million less votes than Obama in 2012. Trump did not get more votes than McCain or Romney, and 3, Trump got 90% of the Republican vote. All these things indicate voter suppression, strong voter identity, and Hillary did almost nothing to get people to vote for something. Yes, those are all themes that I've been hitting here. I agree with you. And you said this maybe a month ago when Clinton was recording Republican votes. Politics actually matter. The Clintons failed to attach Republicans to Trump and vice versa. Yes, indeed. That said, I don't think this election was a light white lash more than any other recent election. It's fair to say that every vote the Republicans receive is white lash. Yes. I mean, I think that's true, too. I do think, like I say, I was tweeting with a guy from Pennsylvania, and he says that that they saw an increase in white vote. I don't know if it's clear that these are, he says, low propensity voters. I need to see more data on that, but, you know, taking his word, that would indicate that, you know, those voters in that tweet storm, that they found those voters. Now, part of that could have been the Comey thing. Just like I wasn't going to vote, but I got contacted by Trump, and I think they're both horrible, but I got contacted by Trump, and he made the pitch. And that's it. Sexy Liberal 44, This American Nausea. Okajik, was at a protest a couple hours last night. Need to be more constructive use of this anger. Keep the ideas coming. Indeed, I think you're right. Dave in Delaware, I feel sick to my stomach on a level of magnitude in which my experience only comparable to news of loved one dying. It's all looking so bleak. I just wanted to offer some encouragement and thank you for the exceptional work you do. You've played a very large part in shaping me politically. And want to say that your other listeners, while many of us will likely make it through the next 4 years relatively unscathed, please do not use that luxurious position as an excuse to stay disengaged. No, you know, I mean, this has been said in many other places, but I mean, if you have a position of privilege, I mean, and whatever that nature of that privilege is, it's not hard to look around and find people who don't have that privilege, whether it's, you know, economic or whether it's they're in, you know, the LGBT community or whether they're Muslim or of color or, you know, immigrant, you know. Help them out in some fashion. I think even, you know, going up to people and saying, you know, we got your back, I think would help at this point. I think there are people out there who are just genuinely scared. I mean, I know that, like,
absolutely.
I feel a, you know, I mean, I mentioned this before, but when we launched Air America, we had to leave with bats. We were afraid. And, you know, it's a different era. But it's not hard to imagine returning back to that type of situation. But Jimmy Reefer Cake, we are the Majority Report. I love poop jokes, and I love your show, Sam. You're honest and funny. I definitely don't agree with all your strategy or predictions. I like open discussion and less people thinking they know what's going to happen in the future. I like truth-induced diarrhea. I was thinking about you. We're saying that voter suppression in the primaries were responsibility of the Republicans. This makes sense because Hillary Clinton was the far more favorable to a Republican. It's a good point. Isabel, I have a problem with the unity and not being called out. I honestly think it's cowardice on the part of Obama and Clinton to make this quite clear. I think Obama and Clinton should say he won, will respect the laws of this country as Trump does, in a collaborative and productive transition of power. But it's essential to say he doesn't govern as he campaigned, and we want the state as strongly as we can possibly that his campaign is not illegitimate but absolutely immoral. Look, I agree with you.
Yes.
I do not think we should normalize this, guys. Ven, I'm not looking forward to First Lady Melania's anti-bullying efforts. Kids, it's never okay to bully others unless they're a fatty or a girl or a cuck, or if their skin is a weird dark color other than orange, or if they have low energy. Other than those exceptions, don't bully anyone. Yes, last thing, cuck, none of this applies to Muslims or Mexicans. Right. And the final I am of the day. Callous Whisper. Oh, here we go. The Daily Trump Dump. Your small-handed moment. Daily Orange Oracle. A moment nowhere near Zen. I like your small-handed moment. All right, folks, see you tomorrow.
It might take all the strength I got to get to where I want, but I know somehow I'm gonna get there. I wasn't looking when I just got caught between the truth and the light bulb. But finding out won't make me feel any better. Yeah, I know the clock is ticking, but the meds are gonna kick in. And my pilot light shining bright. I guess I'm where the choice was made, for the option where you don't get paid, for the road that bends before it finally breaks you. I guess somehow I lost my drive between the 101 and the 5. Do you know how far the detour takes you? Yeah, I know the clock is ticking, but the meds are gonna kick in. And my pilot light shining bright. Shifted.